here within the auditorium and viewing from around the world on live stream. My name is Les Jamieson. I'm one of the organizers of this event that's been in planning since March. And I think you're going to be very, very impressed by what you're going to see and hear this weekend, today and tomorrow. 1 mile away is the epicenter of the events of the 9/11 attacks. And every year when we do these symposiums, we start with a moment to gather our thoughts in commemoration, in remembrance of the horrific consequences of that day, with thousands of people's lives lost, many, many tens of thousands of families impacted by the loss of loved ones, and tens of thousands more people, residents in the area, and first responders negatively impacted. And we very much have them in our thoughts. And of course, 9/11 has affected, you know, every individual on the planet, and I would venture to say continues to impact every single day of our lives because of the consequences of the events. So, and with that, I just want to say that we are at a new stage, an evolutionary stage of 9/11 research, activism, and strategy. And that's what this weekend is about. So, although we're 1 mile away from the epicenter of the attacks, right now we are at the epicenter where very important minds and hearts and souls have come together to pursue justice after 15 years. So thank you for being with us. And just like so much of the analysis of 9/11 deals with the classic conflict between good and evil, I also want to say that we have another classic relationship between optimism and pessimism. And this weekend, you're going to see there's an awful lot of reason for optimism because of the concept, the message, and the individuals who have come together who've traveled from very far distances and believe in the concept of this event, justice in focus. And I have another reason for optimism. I get to introduce a leading scholar in our culture. He's the professor of media, culture, and communication at NYU. He's the author of several books, including Boxed In, The Culture of TV, The Bush Dyslexicon, Observations on a National Disorder, Cruel and Unusual, Bush and Cheney's New World Order, and Fooled Again. Please help me welcome Mark Crispin Miller.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Les, and thanks, too, for setting up this beautiful event, which seems to be likely to work efficiently on the tech level, which is a nice change of pace. Let me thank you all for being here. And when I say you, I mean not only you here in this historic venue at Cooper Union, but all of you out there in cyberspace who are tuning in to the live stream broadcast. This is a very important event. And let me start by making clear what it is we're not doing vis-a-vis 9/11. We are not remembering the victims in an authoritarian and warlike spirit where we try our best to revive the horror and pathos of that original moment in order to justify a prolonged military response all around the world. To give you a pretty vivid example of what I'm talking about, let me take you back to 9/14, 2001, when official Washington was gathered in Washington National Cathedral, and George W. Bush gave a rousing speech that included this passage. Just 3 days removed from these events, Americans do not yet have the distance of history, but our responsibility to history is already clear. To answer these attacks and rid the world of evil. A modest goal. War has been waged against us by stealth and deceit and murder. This nation is peaceful, but fierce when stirred to anger. This conflict was begun on the timing and terms of others. It will end in a way and at an hour of our choosing. Okay, then they all stood up and belted out an unforgettable rendition of the Battle Hymn of the Republic. I have some verses from that anthem that I won't read to you because we're already running late, but you understand what I'm trying to convey. The mood was warlike. It was an expression of national resolve and unthinking unity. We're doing something not only different from that, but radically opposed to it. Whereas Bush cast the terrorist attacks as a crime against America, a crime against America the beautiful, America the good, America the innocent. An attack that had to be answered with endless war all around the world, an attack carried out by 19 Muslim hijackers armed with box cutters under the command of an Islamist zealot in a cave many thousands of miles away, right? A story that had already hit the airwaves the same day as the attacks themselves. We take a different view. We see 9/11 as a crime against humanity, first of all, not against America. A crime against humanity that victimized not just the 3,000 who were killed that day here in the city, and not just all those who have been dying ever since. Even to this day, people are still being diagnosed with cancer from what they inhaled that day down near Ground Zero. But a crime that also includes the millions of victims of our wars on terror all around the world, the millions killed or maimed and or displaced, the millions misdescribed by the New York Times as migrants, as if they were out looking for work. They are refugees, millions upon millions of victims, which makes it fairly reasonable to say that 9/11 was a crime against humanity. And we frankly don't believe the government's conspiracy theory of how that happened. Thank you. But let's hurry on, because that's kind of the theme of the whole 2 days. The official narrative is preposterous on its face. It is a ludicrous explanation. We don't accept it. And so we are not only memorializing the victims, but we're really honoring them in the best way possible by trying to seek justice for them by figuring out what actually happened and who really is responsible. Yeah, war had been waged against us by stealth and deceit and murder. President Bush was right about that, but at whose hands? We don't know. And we would like to know. Now, secondly, we see 9/11 not just as a crime against humanity, but as a crime against democracy. And by that I mean two things. I mean, on the one hand, that traumatic event did what such events always do in history and are meant to do, which is to exalt executive authority beyond the reach of any kind of popular control. Here was a president who had not really been elected, who was terribly unpopular. He'd become a national punchline by that fatal day. And all of a sudden, he was transformed from, you know, Bozo the Clown into Winston Churchill. You remember this? He was FDR squared. He was the greatest leader we could ever possibly imagine. And I guess that means Dick Cheney was as well, since the two were joined at the hip. So he was exalted. Suddenly his non-election was not an issue. the state engaged in, you know, a massive ongoing exercise in global surveillance, infiltration of dissident groups. They set up black sites all around the world where they tortured confessions out of people. The Patriot Act was rushed through Congress. It had already been written by 9/11. It's about yay thick. In various ways, in other words, 9/11 was a very effective crime against democracy, doing what war has always done, doing what war the framers feared would do to our system if it should ever, you know, manage to take over in that way. But 9/11 was also a crime against democracy in another subtler way, and that has to do with the fact that a majority of Americans simply don't believe the official account of 9/11. Now, in order to elaborate on this point, let me take you back to another crucial date that we should all be bearing in mind as we consider this date or tomorrow's date, and that's the day that John F. Kennedy was assassinated, November 22, 1963. That was another crime against democracy. That was a violent coup d'etat that was carried out by unknown actors, plural, and that was explained immediately and very tidily and again preposterously as the work of a lone gunman, okay? Now, it wasn't long really before that official explanation began to unravel. It started to unravel by the mid to late 60s. And as it unraveled, the CIA came up with a brilliant idea for dealing with the critics of the Warren Commission report. And that idea was to smear all critics of the report, to smear anyone who was digging into the facts of that assassination as conspiracy theorists. Okay, there's a book I strongly recommend, Conspiracy Theory in America by Lance DeHaven Smith. The CIA memo laying out this strategy is actually at the back of the book, so this is not itself a conspiracy theory. This is a fact. And from 1967 on, therefore, the phrase conspiracy theory popped up increasingly throughout U.S. journalistic discourse, and to this day, we hear it endlessly, over and over again, to stigmatize and ridicule anyone who dares to raise a question about official narratives, however ludicrous. Now, we're hearing this a lot lately. A lot of eye-rolling and snickering about conspiracy theories and conspiracy theorists. We read that, can you believe this, 61% of the American people think that Lee Harvey Oswald didn't act alone. Can you believe this? Can you believe that so many people subscribe to the view that somehow 9/11 was the work of American actors? Unbelievable, isn't it? This is what the corporate media, and much of the left press too, let me say, continues to say to this day about both these crimes against democracy. And what this amounts to is a suggestion, a strong suggestion, that the American people are idiots, nuts, that they could believe these things. Why don't they simply believe what the state tells them is the truth? Right? Why don't they simply believe what the government tells us happened? All right, that's not the American way, as I understand it. That's an authoritarian position. We don't believe something because the government tells us it's true. Is that not right? Okay. So, you know, I have to hurry to an end. Les is flashing a sign that says zero on it. So let me simply say that I agree with Les, not about the need for me to get off the stage right now. I agree with him that there are signs that are very, very encouraging. If Pete Carroll, the coach of the Seattle Seahawks, is now a 9/11 truther, we're obviously doing something right, right? They're not going to stand for that anthem, right? And we're not going to stand up and belt out the battle hymn of the Republic every time somebody says 9/11. We're going to take a more thoughtful approach. We're going to use our minds. We're going to be genuinely patriotic and raise serious critical questions about the evidence surrounding 9/11. That's what we're here to do this weekend. And I can tell you as a professor that my own students are no longer intimidated by the conspiracy theory meme. it isn't working anymore. These official stories are unraveling because the internet is out there, right? And the sooner they unravel, the better. All right, those are my opening remarks. And now I'm introducing, am I? Yes, thanks, okay. I'm introducing, let's see now. It's my pleasure and my honor to introduce Danny Sheehan, who will himself introduce the first section of today's event, which is the existence of indisputable evidence and the courts. So our initial emphasis today is on the forensics and the legal standard necessary for filing suit. Danny Sheehan is one of America's best known and most influential constitutional and public interest lawyers. He has served in practically all the most important legal cases we've been faced with since the dawn of the Cold War. The Pentagon Papers case, the Watergate break-in case, Iran-Contra, the Karen Silkwood murder case. He's represented victims of Three Mile Island, and he's brought suit against the American Nazi Party for hate crimes. I'm going to, you know, kind of rush through these introductory notes in the interests of time. He will then be followed by our own Richard Gage, the heroic San Francisco architect, who was one of the founders of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. And he will be joined by Professor Leroy Hulsey, a structural engineer who's chairman of the Department of Civil Engineering at the University of Alaska Fairbanks and currently working on the WTC-7 evaluation project. So please join me first in welcoming Danny Sheehan.
Well, good morning, everybody who's here today at this historic Cooper Union. Hello to everybody, the hundreds of people who are around the country and the world watching and listening and following these procedures this weekend over the internet. My name is Danny Sheehan, as Mark had indicated. You'll probably be seeing a number of lawyers here during the course of these next 2 days. So a lot of the people in the audiences who are in fact lay people will probably be expecting to hear at this stage what might be understood from a lawyer point of view as an opening statement. In an opening statement, the lawyers generally are called upon to tell you, as the audience or the jury, what it is that you're going to be hearing over the next couple days. If in fact we're in a defense posture, as I have been in a number of cases, as Mark pointed out, ranging from starting with the Black Panther bombing conspiracy trial here in New York City, the Panther 21, including the Mayor Eddie Carthan case down in Mississippi, the first degree murder defense we did, the Wounded Knee occupation defending the American Indian Movement defendants who'd been arrested in that particular case, or the American Sanctuary Movement or others. If we're in a defense posture, what the lawyers would be telling you here at this point in the opening statement is how clear it is that the government's case is weak. It doesn't really establish what they assert that it does. Mark has made reference to this already, that if in fact we were in a criminal defense posture, we would be obliged as lawyers simply to explain how completely unsupportable the affirmative thesis is that the government has put forth pursuant to which it's prosecuting its case, or in this case, its wars around the world. However, if in fact we find ourselves as lawyers in a position of being the prosecutors or the plaintiffs in a civil case, as I have been in a number of cases throughout the 70s and 80s and 90s, for example, bringing the major case in Boston against the Boston Police Department to stop them from arresting all of the people who were distributing the Black Panther newspaper in Boston, prosecuting the right of journalists to protect their confidential news sources that we took all the way to the United States Supreme Court, establishing the right of journalists to protect our confidential news sources. The Karen Silkwood case that we did, that we prosecuted in Oklahoma, that stopped the construction of all private nuclear power plants in the United States since 1979. In the Three Mile Island case, where we stopped the Nuclear Regulatory Commission in Three Mile Island from pumping radioactive waste materials into the Susquehanna River. And of course, the Iran-Contra case, where we prosecuted that Federal Racketeering Act case against the Enterprise and Oliver North and his associates that stopped the flow of weapons to the Contras in Central America. That in such a case where we are in the plaintiff's position or the prosecutor's position, the lay people and people in the jury, such as the vast majority of you that are here today and around the world listening to us, we in fact have a legal obligation, a moral obligation, and a tactical obligation to explain to you what it is that the evidence, if we're at a trial setting, what the evidence is that you're going to hear over the next couple of days during the trial that is going to convince you either to a clear and convincing level of conviction or beyond any reasonable doubt if it's a criminal case. But the fact of the matter is that we are not here this weekend in that stage. This is not a trial this weekend. This weekend is instead what they call a Rule 11 inquiry under the federal rules of civil procedure before any attorneys can file a major prosecution, civil or criminal, that we have an obligation to undertake a thorough investigation and consult experts, expert testimony, to be able to convince the lawyers that that there is a good faith basis for believing that if we are given access to the federal rules of civil procedure in a civil litigation, that we have enough evidence in hand already to be able to support a reasonable conclusion that given access to the rules of civil discovery, the right to subpoena documents, the right to subpoena witnesses and compel them to provide testimony, if we're given access to these features of our American legal system, we will be able to present in a trial context later evidence that establishes by a preponderance of the evidence every essential element of a claim. Now, what I want to emphasize here to all the people listening around the world is that this case that we're talking about here this weekend is not the same case that has already been filed in the federal district court here in the Southern District of New York. That is the case that's known as In Re Terrorist Attacks of September 11th, which was filed in 2002 by the Motley Rice law firm. And it represents many of the families and the commercial enterprises that were destroyed during the attack. This is not that case. That case is presently on appeal in front of the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. It was dismissed by the Federal District Court back in 2005 on two grounds. One is that some of the defendants who had been named in that case by the Motley Rice law firm had sovereign immunity, such as the Saudi Arabian government and their officials. And therefore, there was not a cause of action that could be prosecuted against them because of their immunity. And secondly, they ruled under Rule 12b-6 that the evidence that was provided at that time in 2002 in their complaint to support their going forward was inadequate as a matter of fact to convince the judge that there was a reasonable grounds to believe that if they were accorded access to civil discovery that they would have been able to establish their case. The court having applied what he called a heightened standard of showing that would be necessary. Now, with regard to those two claims, it's important to point out that yesterday, the United States Congress passed a law which, in fact, has removed the sovereign immunity from any nation state that participated in supporting the 9/11 attackers. This statute that is known as the JASTA is what it's referred to as. This is the Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act. And it was passed by the House of Representatives yesterday by a voice vote. And therefore, the first grounds for the dismissal of that other case, which we refer to as the Motley Rice law firm case, has been removed. Moreover, the federal government has, as you know, released now the 28 pages that have been held secret for 13 years. And now there's a substantial additional amount of information that implicates people from the Saudi government and high-level officials and certain financial institutions and individuals. So therefore, there is a sound grounds for believing that the two grounds on the basis of which the Motley Rice law firm case has been dismissed may well be reversed. But as Mark has pointed out, the fact is that what we are discussing this weekend is in fact a different theory of a case than that which has been filed in the by the Motley Rice law firm. Motley Rice law firm has alleged basically that everything that has been said by the 9/11 commission that investigated the events of 9/11 is basically true, including the 28 pages that have now been revealed, which give them, the plaintiffs in that case, access to the people who perpetrated the events as they were asserted by the 9/11 commission. We are talking about something different here this weekend. We are talking about an alternative or supplemental theory of the case, which would include potentially additional joint tortfeasors, as they refer to them, potential joint conspirators or joint actors that were acting with some of the people that have been charged in the other civil case. And we are going to be discussing this weekend what the evidence is and what the legal theories are that might support the filing and prosecution of a supplemental case, civil case, to the one that has been filed by the Rice, by the Motley Rice law firm. And this other theory of the case is one that needs to be explored this weekend. The evidence that supports the filing and prosecution of an additional civil case will be reviewed. The legal theories that might support the going forward with such a litigation will be explored. So that is what's going to be happening this weekend. This is a publicly held Rule 11 conference under the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure to determine whether or not there exists at the present time adequate factual evidence to support the going forward of this case and adequate legal theories to support the going forward in this case. That is what the question is that's going to be presented here. And if there is, how that might be undertaken, what type of a group of lawyers are going to have to be assembled, what type of public education, grassroots organizing, financial support is going to have to be raised in order to prosecute such a case. And if, in fact, there's not such adequate evidence or legal theories at the end of this weekend, what additional steps need to be taken? What more do we need to do? What more do you need to do as American citizens and people from the world who insist upon discovering the information that has been still concealed? Because a lot more than just the 28 pages have been concealed from the people of the world. That is the task of this potential additional lawsuit under a different theory of the case to find out who else was involved and whether or not this, in fact, the 9/11 events may have been an inside job. Okay, so that's what we're here for the weekend. That's my opening statement, so you'll understand the context of this weekend. And I'm asking you to get out your notepads, take your notes, figure out what the questions are that you want answered from a factual point of view and from a legal point of view in order to support the going forward of such a case. That's your responsibility this weekend. Our responsibility is to present to you what the facts are that are known now and what the legal theories are that we believe may support such a case. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Danny. And he'll be back later in the day to give the keynote, as long as he stays out of small airplanes in the meantime. Just kidding. Now I'm going to sort of reconfirm my introduction of the next two speakers. I jumped the gun there. And let me begin by noting that Richard Gage, who was actually the founder of Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, not one of the founders, as I said earlier, was inspired to that important step because one day in 2006 he happened to hear on the radio an interview with David Ray Griffin, the reluctant 9/11 researcher who has impeccable academic credentials as a professor of theology and had begun to study 9/11 and realized that the official story was ludicrous. It is a happy accident, some might say a miracle, that David Ray Griffin was even on the radio at all discussing this in 2006, and a further happy accident that Richard Gage happened to hear him. This reminds us of the crucial importance of getting something like the truth out through the media. Richard Gage's organization is an indispensable one, a body of over 2,500 licensed architects and engineers whose combined expertise is vastly greater than that of all the various reporters who parrot the talking points that are given them by their editors and or the government to debunk the conspiracy theories about 9/11. So having said that, please join me in welcoming Richard Gage.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. You know, I was driving home from a construction observation and when I heard David Ray Griffin, and I just remember this bizarre feeling. This is insane. What is he talking about? I would have heard about this before. This was in 2006. And the liberal media would have picked this up and run with it. I was a Reagan Republican waving my flag, rooting for Colin Powell, making his case for his indisputable case for weapons of mass destruction. The weeks that followed were disorienting to me. I mean, I remember feeling very, very confused and out of sorts. It was really difficult. I was more naive than you could possibly imagine. Later, as I began to digest this very difficult information, I remember feeling really angry at being so deceived. And that's the gut feeling that motivated me to start the Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. We already had the scholars for 9/11 Truth. We had lawyers for 9/11 Truth early on at that time. Well, I was again naive in my initial assessment that other architects and engineers would be open-minded enough to want to hear this evidence and rapidly assimilate it and join my effort. What a wake-up. It's been a bit of a tough uphill battle for the minds of technical and building professionals. In our 10 years now, we've presented the evidence 550 times to audiences of 100 to 3,000 in 40 countries and more than 100 American cities. This includes our Europe tour last year of 13 cities and our 75-city Cross America tour screening our latest film, Firefighters, Architects, and Engineers. There we go. Expose 9/11 Myths, which features the incisive work of firefighter Eric Lawyer, who founded the Firefighters for 9/11 Truth and Unity. We've been interviewed on TV 36 times, including C-SPAN's Washington Journal for 45 minutes, which became their top viewed video. And we've been on more than 600 radio interviews. We've gotten very efficient, much more professional, and successful within the last several years. We now have 2,700 architects and engineers now signed on to our petition demanding a new investigation. And we woke a whole lot of them up at our massive outreach effort to the American Institute of Architects conventions. As a result of our consistent presence at the conventions and the American Institute of Architects with our World Trade Center evidence booths, over the years, we now have become even an approved provider of continuing education credit at the American Institute of Architects. This is ironic and extraordinary. The architects will be able to watch our landmark DVD, 9/11 Explosive Evidence, and get the required credits that they need to maintain their membership. So this is really great. This followed our increasingly successful ventures into the heart of the annual business meeting at the big conventions, where we put forth resolutions for the vote on the floor with the 400 of the top management and architects in the industry. Last year, we got 3 times more votes than we did on the resolution the year before. Next year, we expect to get an increasing geometric acceleration as well. The word is getting out to architects and engineers. So many of them have come up to us at the booth and said, I got your email and watched that 15-minute DVD on Building 7. Tell me more about it. This is really exciting. They end up co-sponsoring. We had 55 co-sponsors 2 years ago, just over the minimum that's required, and 100 last year. And we're shooting for 1,000 co-sponsors for this resolution next year in Orlando in May. They've clearly changed their tune over time, by the way, the American Institute of Architects. The first year, the AIA board put on a full offensive assault on the convention floor, calling us, the 55 AIA members, conspiracy theorists. As Mark mentioned, we were actually shocked because we had no such theories, just government reports, forensic evidence, eyewitness and video testimony of the explosive demolition of World Trade Center 7. It's pretty cut and dry. It's that which had convinced at least 2,700 architects to join our call for a new investigation, and which will be testifying tomorrow, Sunday, in the proceedings here before the attorneys. The AIA also actually lied publicly in the meeting, stating things like the diesel fuel brought Building 7 down, and that the resolution would be extraordinarily expensive, when in fact it was a no-cost position statement. This was shocking to us, really. Well, last year they resorted to under-the-radar attacks, stating, this resolution would effectively put the institution on record as questioning the validity of the NIST investigation. Duh! Is that so unconscionable? I guess so, since the leadership of the AIA hastily rubber-stamped the NIST report with no attempt at a reasonable peer-reviewed process among us architects. And this, a panel commissioned by the AIA's president in 2014 found every reason to rely on the credibility and findings of the 9/11 Commission. What? Then why in that 571-page report is there not one mention of the collapse, the third worst structural failure in modern history of Building 7? This is incredible. So, there may be a part of the reason why we have most architects and engineers in this country so completely aware of this major catastrophic collapse, which should have been the most talked about and investigated building collapse in history since no plane hit this building. But we're changing that. We're doing our part. In fact, our new Architects and Engineers Outreach Program takes us to the state level this year. We'll attend a dozen AIA engineering conventions, and with our successful booth strategy, we show Building 7's collapse on the screen, and we ask them, did you know a third tower fell on 9/11? They invariably say, no. What does it look like to you? It looks like a controlled demolition. We agree. And the conversation is off and running. At our last state convention in Tennessee, we signed up 38 new co-sponsors. At the Structural Engineering Convention in Las Vegas last year, we signed up on our petition a quarter of the 100 structural engineers that we had the opportunity to talk to out of the 400 that were there. We reached a minimum of 35,000 engineers and architects with our mail-out of 55,000 copies of the 55-page, I've been corrected, it's 48 pages technically, Beyond Misinformation booklet. And most architects and engineers and have written back with us with appreciation, actually. This is extraordinary. Good reviews, and they've signed our petition. Many of them. But we don't stop. We're like a juggernaut at AE 911 Truth. We just completed the mailing, for instance, of 35,000 copies of the most creatively designed professional mailers ever in our history, World Trade Center Physics, in order to appraise the members of the American Architects, American Society of Civil Engineers, of our explosive evidence, to let them know about it. How do we do all this? We ask our supporters, our network worldwide, if they want it to happen. They vote with their pocketbooks. We receive hundreds or sometimes thousands of very small donations, which add up big, that we can do very special projects with and have a great opportunity to break through those projects that do. Like the $8,000 billboard in Times Square, for instance. Whoops, this one. Which is up right now in Times Square for the next month. Right in the face of the New York Times, which quoted 118 or 156, depending on how you count it, first responders citing evidence of explosions, such as this one. I think everybody thought these buildings were blown up. Well, we're overseas now. Our most recent publication in the academic world was in Europe with the Europhysics News. The editors invited us to write for them after they saw one of our Beyond Misinformation booklets. So is the word getting out there? Yeah, it's accelerating. We think that article 15 years later on the physics of the high-rise building collapses has now been read 43,000 times in under 2 weeks. This is really, really good news. So we've got to strive on and continue to reach the academic, architecture, and engineering world and hit them right between the eyes with that 2x4 that hit me that day in May, listening to Bonnie Faulkner's Guns and Butter program. By the way, Bonnie Faulkner is here. I hope you have the opportunity to meet her. Now, we believe that education and research lays the groundwork for justice. And so we erode support for the official 9/11 story step by step in the academic community. The resistance is diminishing. Here's another of our next major steps. It's our WTC7 evaluation, a study we've commissioned at the University of Alaska Fairbanks by Dr. Leroy Hulsey, PhD, one of the top forensic structural engineers in the country. It is a 2-year study using computerized finite element modeling to evaluate objectively, independently, whether fires, the official cause of Building 7's collapse, could have brought this building down, as claimed by NIST. The study is independent, open, and peer-reviewed. Well, tonight, we have brought one of the country's top civil engineers, the chairman of the civil engineering department at the University of Alaska in Fairbanks. Please, it is my great, great honor to welcome to our stage Dr. Leroy Hulsey. Dr. Hulsey.
So do you have Thank you all. I want to first of all begin by thanking you for giving me the opportunity and my students to work on this very important project. I consider it a tremendous honor to be able to work on this, and we have taken this honor and we are working extremely hard to provide the proper science to bring this to give you an idea of what this structure may have been experiencing on that day on September 11th, 2001. So to begin with, let me just start off by saying that I want to thank the 9/11 Truth for giving us this opportunity and speak briefly about the team. I want to kind of give you a quick overview before I get in through all the slides, and then I'll move through those fairly rapidly. So the team I have put together for this study consists of a PhD, recent PhD graduate that's worked with me for quite some time, and another PhD student who is currently working on his PhD that's dealing with the understanding of fires in high-rise structures, particularly steel structures. And that has come about because of this project and what we've discovered to be a lot of unknown variables associated with fires in major structures. So the tools that we are using to evaluate this study has to do with ABACUS, which is a finite element, very sophisticated finite element program. It's a very good program. SAP 2000, which is a program by Computers and Structures out of California. It has the capability of doing nonlinear and large deformation theory capabilities, which basically enables us to do progressive collapse when we are in that process. And also SOLIDWORKS, which we are using to evaluate the heat transfer and temperature distribution through the various structural elements, as well as looking at components of the concrete deck and its composite response to the steel framing within that building. Remember that this is a 47-story building. It's extremely complex. It was extremely complex. It was not symmetrical. There's some elements that are very confusing about the design. And so I wanted to focus today on the NIST report dealing with the fire theory that they presented regarding the failure or the collapse of this building. Our objectives for this study was to, first and foremost, at the beginning, I said I probably would not be able to tell you what brought this building down, but we would focus on what did not bring it down. So, and that's where we are. Keep in mind that there's a lot of information that's not available because of it being removed from the site without us being able to have the opportunity to study it. But we do have enough through the erection drawings and various other things that we've been able to get our hands on that enables us to answer the questions that we've been focused on, which deals with what did not bring this building down. So today, I want to emphasize that we are working at this from an approach that we'll look at every aspect that we can think of that may have affected what went on that particular day, and we'll look at it from a pure scientific point of view and discard those that are not reasonable. So taking that in mind, let's start moving through the slides. This is the investigation of the collapse. The three of us that are working on it is myself, Dr. Fan Shuo, who is my postdoctoral researcher, and Zili Kwan, my PhD student. Our objectives of our study was to evaluate the findings for the collapse presented by NIST. What did not cause this collapse is what we are going to focus on till the completion of this study, examine progressive collapse mechanisms, and provide a summary of findings and conclusions. Today, this presentation, I will attempt to answer the question, did WTC-7 collapse due to fire? Our methodology is as follows. So our approach was as follows. We first began by taking the erection drawings and the various things available to us to develop a virtual structural model. The programs we're using, as I've already mentioned, are AutoCAD, to put it all into a electronic media, SAP 2000, Abacus, and SolidWorks. I put together a quality control program immediately so that we have non-disputable science to become our priority, and the team meets daily to question our findings and formulate an approach for the next step, and we do that at the end of each day. Both Dr. Shao and Mr. Quinn use different programs to solve the problem. As an example, to look at what I'm going to present to you today, we use both SAP 2000 and we also use Abacus, and they were done separately, and to verify our results to get very close to the same answers. Dr. Shaw performed analysis using AutoCAD and Abacus. Primarily, the Abacus models dealt with looking at the connections. And Mr. Kwan used AutoCAD, SAP 2000, and SolidWorks. My focus is to ensure that scientific solutions are not influenced by previous research. Once the results are tested, the information will be thoroughly evaluated by our peers, and we intend to put together a peer evaluation committee prior to completion of this work. And then once that has been reviewed and scrutinized, then we intend to put it out and publish it in the literature. I want to also point out something that's really quite important here. We typically, as educators, educate structural engineers with the idea that we need to have safe buildings, make sure that the loadings are correct, make sure that we have the proper safety factors, but attention is not given to heat transfer or thermal distribution, temperature distributions. We rely pretty heavily on test data in terms of providing 1 hour and 2 hour fires and so forth. And we discovered through this process that most of that is basically a wall systems and not necessarily three-dimensional structural systems. So the other thing to recognize is when you have thermal response, you end up with things like radiant heat, convection, conduction, and these various aspects are working simultaneously. And so in order to have a movement within a building or anything else, the building can literally, or any kind of structure, let's examine, for example, if I was to take just a thin rod, and if I was to heat up that rod and it was unrestrained, the rod and it was a uniform temperature, there would not be any consequence. However, if I restrained its ends and heated it up, and if it was a piece of steel, about 200 degrees Fahrenheit would cause major problems for that little piece of steel. It doesn't matter how long it is. It matters about the fact it was restrained. If I took a concrete deck and I was to increase the temperature, it would take about 150 degrees if I totally restrained it. But if it was not restrained, it could basically continue to move and not have a problem. That's pretty significant about what I'm going to share with you today, because there is a point where if you heat something up and there's restraints within it, it's going to move with respect to the stiffest point within something. So we looked at the material properties of the concrete, the steel. We looked at what kind of aggregate perhaps was used for this particular concrete placement. The best I could tell is it's probably a local aggregate, such as a dolomite concrete aggregate. We looked at the diaphragm behavior of the concrete floor system. We looked at and examined the point of zero movement, which is that stiff point I'm referring to in the floor system. Concrete steel floor interaction, composite, non-composite, and partially composite was all examined. We looked at the influence of shear studs, and there was a big controversy about this, about whether there were shear studs at the girders versus no shear studs at the girders, so we looked at both. In every particular case, we looked at the extremes, both with and without, to try to examine what may have happened. Because this is a really complex building, 47 stories, it would take a huge amount of computer time to analyze this structure in a virtual system. So we utilized substructuring, broke the various pieces down, broke the floor down into equivalent behavior so that it would expedite the processing time and still get the same results. So we looked at the concrete floor, looking at both the fluted of stay-in-place forms. It behaves differently in two different directions. Looked at the welded wire fabric contribution in it. Looked at the heat transfer through that whole system as well as the stiffness of all of that. Looked at every connection within that building. We broke it down and put springs to model the behavior of the connectors and looked at their response. And so those springs to replace those floors from 3 to 11 and 14 to 47 we examined to try to get an understanding of how floors 12 and 13 may have responded. Because, listen, today we're focusing on column 79. We looked at nonlinear springs to replace all those connection types. We looked at heat transfer, considering a drop ceiling, the fireproofing, no fireproofing, the heat conduction and resistance of each one of those particular products. So our approach, the research team, investigated the building in two ways. We examined the NIST approach, and we looked at our modeling. The numerous conditions were examined to evaluate structural response versus fire location. So we moved those fires around. I need to point out to you one thing. We did not do much about creating new fires. We used the NIST fire, the idea being that if we got their same results, okay, then we have to ask different questions. But if we did or did not have a problem with the column 79 using their models, then all of a sudden we have a big issue. So numerous conditions were examined to evaluate structural response versus their fires, and we looked at the worst fires that they had recommended, the effect of no shear studs versus the shear studs over the girders, fully composite versus non-composite versus partially composite. We looked at other conditions such as no fire protection, the effects of welded wire fabric on the in the flutes or in the concrete deck, the flutes, the stay-in-place forms on the heat transfer. We looked at airspace below the system where you would have had a drop ceiling, but determined the fire would probably have gone in there fairly quickly if the fire was below. So some of the NIST discussion points that I want to bring out. Please focus on this slide. This slide, if you'll look at it, represents floor, in this case, floor 13. The red that you see and the brown and the black are the framing in that plan view of that floor. But the blue represents what NIST did in terms of putting and approximating the connections using springs. The portion outside of that, they did not do that. They did not put springs to represent the connections in that left space. I want you to remember this. That means that the system in the right, the blue side, is going to be more flexible than the side that's to the left in the red. Also, they didn't model the exterior framing with springs. And when I say springs, I'm saying that's a substructuring technique that we use to try to cut the computer time down, give us the equivalent of what that connector really was. So their argument was the following. They lost lateral support at the buckling initiation at column 13 because it moved, the girder moved so much as to push the column off the bearing, and as a result of then it had progressive collapse because they lost lateral support. He also said that the outside selected area connection failures were not modeled, such as a fix or pin were used. That's that red area I was just referring to you. The connections were not modeled in the exterior moment frame either. So NIST also said on 19, page 525 in 2008, that a girder was considered to have lost vertical support when its web was no longer supported by the bearing seat. Thus, the bearing seat at column 79 was 11 inches wide, and when that girder end at the column 79 had been pushed lateral at least 5.5 inches, it was no longer supported by the bearing, and then you lost lateral support, and so forth and so on. Let me point out to you that the video on the left, and I don't see where. Anyway, I have a video which would show you the behavior of this, and I don't see it on this slide, but it was on my PowerPoint. So there's basically what's going to show up here, unfortunately, is if you take a look at the failure on the left, which is the real building, and the failure on the right building, you would see a whole different condition. And here's what you would see. So this is the picture, and I turned this picture around. But so the left side is where the springs are, the right side is where the springs are not. And if that building began to fail, the left side went down faster than the right side, which is not what you saw in reality in the real building. So that separated progressive collapse, which means, by the way, that their model was not accurate, nor correct. So this picture, none of these, for whatever reason, crap, I'm sorry. Well, how do I get it back?
You need an architect.
I guess.
All right, let's do this.
I don't know why. Oops. These videos are not running.
Did you have them running automatically?
Oh, yeah.
You sent them to me?
Yeah.
Because I didn't know they were videos. I just copied them in.
Okay.
Just that one.
Okay, yeah. So this should have been a video that would show the failure of this thing, and I apologize that it's not showing that. But so the NIST approach, they had an excess of 5.5 inches moving at girder bearing support column 79. And those issues that led to that movement were, number one, non-composite of the main girders, which was pretty insignificant, quite frankly. Neglected thermal expansion of the concrete slab. They did not consider the expansion of the concrete slab, and yet the concrete slab is there. It's moving with the steel. And even if you said it was separated, there's a frictional component between the steel and the concrete, and it's going to move. And so there's a mu normal, which is the normal weight of that concrete acting down on it. And until you cause it to slip, it's going to be working with it. The separated connection modeling was a major, major factor in how they ended up with the 5.5 inches of movement, and the mixed white web flange stiffeners were also missed by them. So UAF structural approach was to use two modeling programs. We had quality control. We developed the nonlinear springs for the structural connections everywhere to ensure that we ended up with what the structure acted like instead of what the structure may not have acted like. We looked at both composite, partially composite, and non-composite response, which is significant in gravity loads, but not in terms of the thermal response. Floors 12 and 13 springs were examined, and we looked at thermal expansion of those systems. SAP 2000 floors 12 and 13, and floors 3 to 47 were in the process, has been modeled as a virtual system. And fire NIST fire models were used to examine what our results might have been through this process, and then we looked at the heat transfer, which was another fire model that we put together, which was pretty significant. The UAF research approach continued with a steel framing, so we have connections, column to beam, beam to girders, throughout this structure, and those are all modeled by nonlinear springs. And the reason we're doing that is because as the structure begins to fail, we want to be able to model and understand how those connectors are working interactively with the steel framing. We substructured the entire structural system so we could analyze fairly quickly of potential failure mechanisms throughout this building to utilize and minimize computer time. Heat transfer was studied for the following. We looked at the floor covering, the welded wire fabric within the floor, stay-in-place forms. With the air, flutes of airspace between, we can treat it as insulated and non-insulated in that area between the floor framing. We looked at drop ceiling. We looked at that stagnant airspace between the drop ceiling and the steel system. We looked at fire protection versus no fire protection. And we looked at also equivalent concrete conductivity and thermal expansion accounting for dolomite aggregate within the concrete deck, welded wire fabric, and the geometry for the section. Okay, I'm about there. NIST also didn't realize or made a mistake in not including the web stiffeners at the girder column 79, and so we did, and this is what our model on your left looks like. And so I wanted to just kind of look at and show you the sampling of what we did in terms of our connectors. We had a low deformation of this is a shear connector located at a spot on your right-hand side by STC. We gave it a name. We did that for lots of different ones. This is the abacus connection model that we're using. This shows you finite element-wise how it looks. This is a low moment rotation curve for it. This is a shear deformation curve that we'll have for it as well. This is a SAP model of all 43 to 47 stories. This is the view of the UAF SAP model using SAP 2000. And you'll notice that with the 5,142 kips acting as gravity load at the time this failure occurred, there was a displacement was 1.92 inches at column 79 instead of 5.5 inches. We also looked at all the material properties, and I've listed them here for you to look at briefly. A572 was a 50 KSI steel. Thermoconductivity was 35 BTUs per hour per degree Fahrenheit. We had a thermal strain, which is the same as NIST had recommended. We looked at the concrete behavior based upon what was used there. And so this kind of gives you an idea of, remember that 5,142 kips is what this thing would have loaded at. The NIST columns didn't reach higher than 392 degrees Fahrenheit based on NIST's report. Their argument was that it was all about expansion. So the NIST fires, here's what the fires we used for the temperature distribution. And column 79 through abacus gave me 1.85 inches of movement instead of 5.5. I have a comparative table here to give you an idea of floor framing steel connection springs. We modeled those. NIST only modeled part of them. Exterior steel framing connections were modeled both by modeled by us. NIST did not. Girder to column stiffener plates were used. NIST did not. Floor composites with beams, not girders. We both did those. Floors composite with beams and girders. We looked at them. They did not. Thermal expansion of the concrete deck. We looked at that. They did not. Thermal conductivity expansion for material properties. We looked at them, and they did not. Our thermal movement at column 79 was less than 2 inches. Therefore, our conclusions are the concrete floor diaphragm stiffness is insignificant, and with no shear connector, frictional resistance to thermal expansion is not trivial. The thermal expansion for the concrete deck cannot be ignored, and it's likely that less than steel the value because it's based on the aggregate, 70% aggregate. The research team evaluated by considering airspace below, and I've already mentioned that, so I know I'm running out of time. NIST vertical collapse was not consistent with that of the actual collapse. The difference was primarily influenced by not modeling a significant portion of the structural framing. Remember, that's stiffer than the other, and so it moved a lot farther along. Matter of fact, the stiffest area within that system is around column 79.
So what's next? We will finalize placing springs at every floor in SAP 2000 model. We will conduct progressive collapse by failure at the substation level, shock waves. We'll look at that by the falling debris from the towers. We looked at radiant heat from towers 1 and 2. We examined the building's response for various columns being taken out. And we will initialize placing springs at every floor of the SAP 2000 model. Okay, that being said, I'm going to move to here. Did Building 7 collapse from fires? And the answer is no. UAF finding shows that the girder bearing at column 79 moved less than 2 inches. It would not have been a problem. It did not have a problem in lateral buckling, not using their fires. Thank you.
What does that mean? I can't tell you how important what you just heard is. Now, you may not have understood all of it, but what it means is that this is a direct challenge to the computer analysis that NIST did to prove their collapse by fire theory. They juggled this football for 7 years, hoping everybody would forget about it and go home and not talk about it anymore, because here is the worst example of a deception of all of 9/11, because it's so clear. This building, as you'll see in the evidentiary hearings tomorrow, dropped like a rock straight down uniformly, symmetrically into its own footprint in under 7 seconds at free fall acceleration. Dr. Hulsey just proved that that cannot happen by fire. That means all of academic institutions across this country and around the world have been lied to. And they probably knew this. Tomorrow we're going to talk about what can remove all 80 columns in this building that would allow it to fall at free fall. That is the second part of this discussion. But this particular study needs to go through the peer-reviewed process. It needs to be completed. We've got 6 to 8 months of additional finalizing, shoring up work that has to be done at the university with his PhD students. And then it goes out to the academic community. And it will change the game. It will be peer-reviewed. It will waken architects and engineers across the country, throughout academia, to become the most studied building failure in history. It's been hidden and suppressed so far, but it can't be after this is out. Now, that's why we need your help to support this very expensive project. So please see me personally, or go to WTC7evaluation.org and support the project with your ongoing pledge. It is absolutely essential that it gets done, and we'll let you know in our forthcoming emails about it as well. If you haven't gotten, if you're not getting our emails, and they're almost every week now because there's so much going on, please go to ae911truth.org and sign up on our email newsletter. Thank you so much, and I'll turn it back over to our MC, Mark Crispin Miller.
Thank you, Richard, and thank you, Dr. Hulsey. I was delighted to have Richard stress the takeaway for all of us. It's important to understand the truth of that old adage that a lie travels all the way around the world while the truth is still getting its boots on. You've heard this, right? People who are trying to tell the truth about complicated issues like this are at the disadvantage of having to be extremely precise and careful according to the rules of science, whereas the debunkers, the hired liars and so on, don't have to do that. They simply rely on the script that has the talking points in it. The talking points are very simple. And importantly, the talking points tell the mass audience what the mass audience would prefer to hear. Okay? So the story that the collapse of Building 7 was perfectly innocent, that's an attractive story. It fits into the attractive larger narrative of 9/11 as an attack by 19 Islamic terrorists with box cutters, etc. So, whatever controversy you're talking about, the same was the case with the JFK assassination. The ballistic evidence, the medical evidence, the really serious discussion of these things took tremendous time and care, which doesn't necessarily translate into the kind of simple language that we need in order to move masses of people. So we're very lucky to have heard this whole presentation today. Now, we'll move on from the how of 9/11 to the why of 9/11. And to help us toward that larger and far more frightening understanding, we're extremely lucky to have Ferdinando Imposimato here to join us today to talk about 9/11 as strategy of tension. Ferdinando Imposimato is the Honorary President of the Italian Supreme Court and a former Italian senior investigative judge. He presided over several terrorism-related cases in Italy, including the kidnapping and murder of President Aldo Moro and the attempted assassination of Pope John Paul II. He's a Grand Officer of the Order of Merit of the Republic of Italy. In his juristic capacity, his investigative capacity, he came to realize the extreme importance of Operation Gladio in modern Italian history. He's author of the books The Big Lie, International Terrorism, The Republic of Unpunished Tragedies, The 55 Days That Changed Italy, about the Moro case, and I think most relevantly for us, the book Strategy of Tension. He has recommended that the crimes of 9/11 be tried at the International Criminal Court, which was set up to protect the world from criminal acts of war. So he's a man of considerable courage, as well as judicial expertise. Now, his presentation will be followed by a Q&A. So if you have some questions for him, please write them on your index cards. I'll get them, and we'll take care of that after his talk, and he'll be accompanied by a translator. So if we're ready, please join me in welcoming Judge Imposimato here today.
Yes. Can I speak?
No, I don't.
Ladies and gentlemen, before making my modest speech about the strategy of tension that I want to dedicate to the 9/11 war victims and of terrorism and wars, I need to thank the organizers, the attorneys, experts for putting on this important event at the wonderful Cooper University. I apologize for my English in advance, but will do my best for all of you here and around the world. One of the greatest ancient historians, the Greek Thucydides, said, "We must know our past to understand the present and be able to predict the future." Our history, as we know, is polluted with the fabrication, silence, and misinformation, starting from the true masters of the massacres and the political crimes. This is because modern democracies, often masking tyrannical regimes, use the media as instruments of disinformation and distortion of people's conscience to feed mass fear for preventive wars. There is no future without truth and justice. Speaking of strategy of tension, we cannot influence by the trials and verdicts of guilty or not guilty, but by inert behavior of the nations involved. As regards the truth, there are often two truths, the historical and the judicial truth, which do not coincide with one another. The historical truth is often only the probable truth, but we cannot build the history only on the basis of scientific and mathematical evidence that often is impossible to get. Before speaking about the 9/11, I like to describe the birth of the strategy of tension in Italy, which dates back in 1947. The banditry of Giuliano, who supported of the separation of Sicily from Italy and Italy's annexation by the United States. The first massacre happened in Italy was that Portella delle Giunestre on May 1st. In April, the People Bloc Party won the elections in Sicily against the Christian Democratic Party. This victory alarmed the landowners, the Italian politicians, and the United States. In response, on May 1st, Giuliano's men fired a series of machine gun rounds at demonstrators, killing adults and children. There were also some Italian politicians amongst the instigators of the massacre. The United States government, for its part, provided weapons and financial support to the authors of this attack. The American consul in Rome was accused of having provided weapons. The American Michael Stern confirmed that the United States has supplied Giuliano with weapons. Portella della Ginestra was always reproduced during the strategy of tension that would involve the mafia, politics, and institutions. The NATO bases in Italy. NATO's purpose was to defend Europe against a possible attack by the Soviet Union. But NATO also pursued other tasks, interfering in many countries' internal politics, using terrorist attacks and organized crime. The neo-fascist terrorist Roberto Cavallaro admitted to be a member of Gladio. He claimed that Gladio structure was a group of army officers who used civilians with the aim to provoke chaos and a forced reaction by the military. The Italian premier, a NATO general, and officers all met at Michele Sindona's house, who was a known mafioso and a member of the P2, the Italian Masonic Lodge. You can see in the picture all these subjects together in the same Via Sicilia, OSS, CIA, Gladio stay behind, New Order, terrorist covered by society, the office of Lodge P2, and other office connected with the Red Brigade and Gaddafi. The Parliamentary Commission on the P2 Freemasonry, chaired by Tin Anselmi, wrote in 1960, the P2 Lodge, led by Licio Gelli, conspired with the criminal organizations such as the mafia and the terrorist groups, helping United States government interference in Italian policies. Gelli invoked extreme measures and the tools for an orthodox war. Gladio stayed behind. According to Italian Parliament, Gladio was a military organization belonging to the deep state, which interfered systematically with Italian democracy, destroying or preventing progressive government. The Parliamentary Commission, led by the Honorable Republican Libero Gualtieri, declared that Gladio Stay Behind was an illegal organization operating under United States government control. He added that it was led in Italy by the American intelligence service, which had an agreement with the Italian secret service for using Gladio as an instrument for the strategy of attention. Gualtieri was threatened by terrorists because of his investigation on Gladio Stay Behind. He assessed that all the Gladio operation had prior approval from the United States government, which was kept informed by the United States ambassador. The secret 1967 and the 1969 reports on the strategy of attention. As an investigative judge, I wondered, does the deep state really exist? And if so, what is the role of this in the strategy of attention? I did not receive an answer to my question until many years after that. Then, in 2012, I discovered three important documents from 1967 and 1969 regarding the deep state, the strategy of attention, and the hidden war. At the trial for the Piazza Fontana massacre carried out by terrorists, which saw Emilio Alessandrini as prosecutor, Senator and my friend, Judge Gerardo D'Ambrosio from Napoli, gave me a conclusive speech in 2012 with those three important documents I mentioned. This document had been hidden in a Montebelluna bank by Giovanni Ventura, who belonged to the terrorist group Ordine Nuovo, and by a secret agent named Zeta, who were both accused of the Piazza Fontana attack. This document mentioned the deep state government and pression services like the Bilderberg Group. The 1967 document stated the charges of interference in the internal politics of European countries against the United States intelligence are absolutely true. The report added American dollars that were supposed to maintain the whole Cold War effort were being sent to left-wing and Catholic organizations. The document revealed the names of leaders who were running this global plot. If the root of this international plot is located in Washington, then many more holes are located in Rome and in Vatican. The report recognized that the international pressure groups are bringing the free world into disorientation and into a general chaos, and that was the strategy of attention. The May 1969 document clarified the political project in Italy to return to a central operation that would be carried out through a creation of a favorable public opinion, changing the top management at Rai TV and the purchase of the press released by financial groups. B, waves of terrorist attacks to convince public opinion of the danger of keeping a socialist approach with industrial groups in northern Italy, isolated groups of neo-fascists to set off devastating bombs. The report ends with a dark and ominous quote from Robert Kennedy, the new candidate of the so-called liberal force for the 1967 election. The American liberals find themselves ideologically closer to Karl Marx later than to the typically liberal 20th century Europe. The T4 explosives in NATO bases. The Italian judges assessed that the explosive used in Piazza Fontana massacre originated from a NATO base. as confirmed to Parliament by the General Maletti and confirmed by President Cossiga. In May 1991, as a member of the Partito Democratico Socialista, the Parliament Commission President and I held interrogation in the 139 Gladio bases around the country. We found out that tons of explosives were being held there. Gladio had been built in a solid way that was hidden and clandestine, whose members were mafiosi, terrorists, titulars, masons, army officers, intelligence, politicians, Ministry of Interior officials, and industrialists. It was stressed that the powerful explosive used in every massacre in Italy were T4 of military origin. The massacres aimed at provoking anger amongst the people, with the nation's reaction being that political power would have to be used for a strong repression against the people who provoke maim and murder. The head of the Secret Service, Maletti, was involved in this strategy, accused of aiding and abetting the authors of the massacres. He and General Sandovito were both convicted of their crimes. No answer was given to me by the government as a senator of the Italian Republic, implicitly confirming that Gladio was a subversive organization against democracy. Judge Leonardo Grassi discovered Gladio in 1992. Judge Grassi wrote, "The discovery of Gladio was of extreme importance in all the trials for the massacres committed in Italy. Several people provided with a great deal of evidence regarding the connection between the massacres committed in Italy since 1969 by the terrorists and the leaders of the Italian secret services in order to fight the Communist Party in Italy." Grassi went on to say that the official theory of Gladio's only objective was to fight a possible invasion by the Soviet Union was false. This theory was incorrect and disproven by evidence. The technique utilized by Gladio after terrorist attacks was to freeze the investigation via covert means, falsely accusing the innocent of being guilty. The Justice Court in Milan wrote in August 2016 that the Brescia massacre had been committed by the right-wing terrorist Ordine Nuovo with support from Italian and the United States military, also known as Gladio Stay Behind. And the Moro kidnapping, I was investigating George in this case. On the basis of research, as an investigating judge and historian, I here state that Italian Premier Aldo Moro was a Gladio victim. I discovered the truth 30 years after Moro's death through the Steve Pizzenik confession, and this extremely important full report, which were written from Italian judges by the Italian Minister of Interior. Steve Pizzenik, a United States Department agent and Henry Kissinger advisor, also became the advisor to the Italian Minister of Interior as the Crisi Committee member, and I did not know anything of this fact. Mr. Pizzenik hindered and stopped the judge's investigation into the old Moro kidnapping, and the murder. Pitsenik said, "I am confessing that it was me who prepared the strategic manipulation which led to the death of Aldo Moro with the aim of stabilizing the Italian situation. The Red Brigade could have released Moro, and in a way that would have undoubtedly obtained great success and increased their legitimacy. Instead, my strategy of creating unanimous disgust and of terrorist activity was even more successful. The price to pay was moralized. My strategy was that no individual is indispensable to the state. The trap was that the Red Brigade had to kill Moro. I tricked them so well that they had no choice but to kill the prisoner. The Italian Minister of Interior knew of the game we were playing. The decision," said always Pitsenik, "to kill Moro was not to take lightly. We discussed it many times, but the minister managed to keep to this strategy. And together, we took a difficult decision for the Moro death. In 2015, Pitsenik was formally accused, not by me, because I was resigned, of complicity in the Moro case. And on the basis of indubitable legal evidence proving Pitsenik's participation in Moro homicide, Pitsenik was the officer to Italy in the charge of NATO, British and German secret services, as stadium members, were also involved from the first day of the kidnapping in trying to find out where Moro was being held. Gladio's final objective was to stabilize the Democrazia Cristiana right political power. Moro murder was the beginning of the terrible social and economic crisis that Italy has suffered since then. 30 years after the Aldo Moro killing, President of the Republic Cossiga told the journalist, "From a panorama that special Gladio units had been employed in the hunt for Moro. It is true, Gladio was involved. They were the famous division of the Italian intelligence service, but there were also British and German and the United States Steve Pitsenik. A secret report of the German BND on the role of Gladio in the hunt for Moro was sent to the Italian minister who visited the famous Gladio base in Sardinia, Capo Marraggio. President Obama would have opened an investigation into the Moro case against Pitsenik, but I am still waiting for a result of this personal request. Gladio massacred Capaci, Judge Falcone, and the Via D'Amelio, Judge Borsellino, my dear friends. In May 1992, anti-mafia judge Giovanni Falcone, his wife Francesca Morvillo, who was also a magistrate and the only known woman murdered in Italy for the profession and the trip, police bodyguards were blown up by a ton of T4 explosive of NATO origin. In June 1989, Falcone had escaped another attempt on his life in Adaura, Sicily. A student of Catania University and the Gladio member admitted in front of a judge in Trapani that the Gladio structure in Sicily had committed several crimes over the last 20 years, including the attempted murder of Falcone in Adaura, the assassination of Piersanti Mattarella, the brother of the President of the Republic, and the assassination of Honorable Pio La Torre. According to a credible mafioso who had been detained in the United Kingdom in the very early 19th, Italian Secret Service, together with the British and the United States counterparts, went to the jail near London and obtained the name of an expert bomb maker who was from the Ordine Nuovo to kill Falcone. Falcone's electronics diary was delivered to a journalist, in which it was quite clear that he was investigating Gladio's crimes. According to Falcone, all the above assassinations and attempt, plus some not mentioned above, had Gladio's handprint all over them. The tie between the Sicilian mafia and Gladio was Vito Ciancimino, who was a Palermo mayor. He was a member of Gladio. Another informant told the court in Palermo that Paul Borsellino had been killed by a member of Gladio. Another member of Gladio in the Italian embassy in Bulgaria told me that Falcone and Borsellino had been killed because of their dangerous investigations into political power. The strategy of tension in Algeria. In January 2001, a former Algerian army general, Habib Souaidia, who asked me to write a introduction of his book, admitted to be responsible with other government officers of several massacres in Algeria between 1980 and 1991. He told me that Islamic terrorists had been charged, even though innocent, by the Algerian authority. He described the ferocious attacks carried out by the security services. Terrorism appeared to be both armed fundamentalist groups antagonizing the political system, as well as an instrument used by the deep state, not in defense of democracy, but to preserve its own private interest on to reach position of high power. I added in January 2001, before the 9 September, as Europe could sooner or later be crushed by these same explosive phenomena. It is now our moral and political duty to reestablish this transparent truth for everyone. 9 September 2001. In my book, in 2005 book, The Big Lie, I wrote that the September 11 attacks was an operation aimed to justify the March 2003 war against Iraq and Saddam Hussein, thought up and prepared well before 9 September. That war was sold to us as a part of the fight against Al-Qaeda. That theory was renounced by the President Bush on the 2nd December 2008 in ABC TV interview, where he admitted a mistake in going to war with Iraq caused by wrong information by the intelligence services about the presence of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. Former British Tony Blair, Prime Minister Tony Blair, was also told the truth on the 25 October 2015 for the war in Iraq. There are elements of truth in the theory of a link between the invasion of Iraq and the rise of the Islamic State. I apologize for the planning and evaluation errors. The Iraqi war was the beginning of other wars and that led to anarchy in Northern Africa and the birth of the ISIS. The intervention in Iraq was justified by two prior revelations to 9 September. A, Saddam had attempted to import raw uranium from Niger. B, that it was needed for constructing an atomic device. On the 1st of December 2000, 9 months before 9 September, the British Joint Intelligence Committee wrote a report from unconfirmed source saying that the Iraqis are showing interest in buying uranium. Where was this Nigergate plan first devised? It was amongst a group of neocons in America that had been inserted into the White House and the Pentagon led by Paul Wolfowitz. It was implemented in England and in Italy, and then spread by British intelligence soon after with the blessing of the United States. The neoconservative, according to the former Secret Service Sergeant Michael Ledeen, would have supplied Karl Rove with documents about the weapons of mass destruction with which Bush justified the invasion of Iraq on 2003. The possible attack against Iran. For the planet war against Iran, the deep worldwide government pulls the strings of national governments, the economic and the military power centers, and the mass media, feeding more terrorism for using in favor of a new American-led world order. The media make the people incapable of understanding what is really happening around them. Mohamed Al-Baradei, director of the Atomic Energy Agency at the United Nations and Nobel Peace Prize, warned that there is information and misinformation. The war in Iraq was the first act of a long operation to create the conditions of a global conflict that will allow world domination by the United States of America. The end of Saddam was their first target with this comical trial and not so comical execution in 2006. Muammar Gaddafi was their second in 2011, which was also extremely successful and a lot quicker than having to put Saddam on trial. General Flynn and Michael Ledeen. The war against Iran remains in the will of a presidential candidate indicated by a former chief of the CIA, a threat for America. Trump's advisor, General Flynn, for foreign policy, truth is that America real enemy is Iran, Corriere della Sera, August 25, 2016. Michael Ledeen and General Flynn wrote a book together, The Field of Fight, during the presidential campaign they presented in August. This book, Flynn states, Iran is a sponsor of extremist terrorists. I do not recommend the next United States president renews the September 2015 nuclear agreement. We have to think that Professor Michael Ledeen, author of the same book, share this strategy. Italy could be involved in possible attack against Libya and Iran. There are some circumstantial evidences of NATO's will to wage war against Iran, like the plan to make the tiny island of Santo Stefano in Sardinia into a NATO base. The island was already a NATO support base since 2008, and houses of atomic missiles there. In August 2016, the Italian Ministry of Defense decided to turn Santo Stefano into an operational base for possible mission in the Mediterranean. The Sardinian region opposed this, rejecting warships docking there. Sardinia also opposes the manufacture near its capital city of Cagliari of the MK3 bombs that Italy supplied to Saudi Arabia until 2015, which were used against the Shiites. The neocon could involve in Italy in a war against in Iran, as they managed to do with Iraq. At that time, Italy's premier and Italian government wanted to amend the Article 78 of the Italian Constitution, approved by legal majority according to Corte Costituzionale, so that only the Chamber of Deputies, which could be over the premier control in force of new electoral law, could make the war declaration. According to the reform coming by the government and approved by an illegal majority, the Italian Senate should be excluded by participation to a possible war declaration. As now, instead, it is established by the Italian Constitution. That constitutional reform is dangerous for the world peace because aims to make easier for Italian government the war declaration. For example, North Africa, and to make war on some country, as happened for the war against Iraq. The Italian reform is in full agreement with the theory of the preventive war, pursued by some neocons, who are now in prominent position inside the Italian government. President Obama seems to have supported our constitutional reform proposed by the Italian government. But we do not know the authors of the draft of reform. Probably the President Barack Obama, we appreciate very much for his courage and the farsightedness in approving the nuclear agreement of Vienna 2015, signed by United Nations, United States, China, Great Britain, France, Germany, European Union, and the base, was not aware of that part of the reform of the Italian Constitution regarding the Article 78. At this regard, I am in favor of the approving the foreseen of the crime of aggression before International Criminal Court, as it was approved by some countries, as Austria, Belgium, Finland, Germany, Spain, Switzerland, Slovakia, Poland, Luxembourg. On the contrary, Italy, United States, Russia, Great Britain, China, and other countries have not still signed the amendment of the International Criminal Court Statute, which introduced the crime of aggression. That means the planning, preparation, initiation, or execution by a person in a position effectively to exercise control over the direct the political or military action for his, of a state of an act of aggression which, by its character, gravity, and scale, constitutes a manifest violation of the Charter of the United Nations. Conclusion. My conclusion is that it still exists. There is still a worldwide deep state, ruthless and bloodthirsty. It exists and uses terrorism, mind control, and general chaos for preventive wars. There are several cases all over the world demonstrating that terrorist attacks have been protected and encouraged before they happened, that those who were responsible of the state terrorism have not been punished. Terrorism must be fought without a doubt, but we have the we have to respect the human rights as we did in the fight against Red Brigade, refusing the torture which helped terrorism and war. History is full of crimes committed in the name of democracy, peace and freedom. Terrorists must be fought, but also by unmasking those who use terrorism as an excuse to make the preventive wars. The planet public opinion is never available to discuss under the pretext of the fight against terrorism, new wars, and the massacres of the civilians and the children, as in Fallujah, or the civilian hospitals in Iraq and Syria. It is wrong to believe that nuclear war against Iran and Russia can be by the United States and its European allies. If it comes to war, it will be the Europeans and mainly Italians that will pay the ultimate price, as told the general about the danger for Italy in the first place. For the treason of European leaders, as Europe will cease to exist. War with Russia and Iran is way beyond United States capability. We reject Machiavelli theory as the spiritual leader of world politics. He had been the source of so many past and present evils in Italy and around the world. No state should be allowed to gain and hold on the power with license to kill and carry out massacres, widely used by some rulers of the past and present as a tool for political struggle. I am convinced that unpunished acts such as massacres, assassinations, and bombings are not compatible with noble purposes such as the defense of peace, freedom, and democracy. This bloody thirsty means only led to having rulers who govern thanks to their claims, lies, and to the people's ignorance. Democracy will only be possible with transparency and truth, by discovering which occult powers are really behind the massacre and with the revival of a great moral tension and the awareness that politics indeed science if morality does not go end in end to govern nations. I hope that the United States, which generously fought against Nazism and fascism in defense of European freedom, suffering for the loss of many human beings, come back to defend the peace and help our fragile democracies in Europe and all over the world. We oppose the invisible world state, which wants the preventive war that is a tragedy, that can cause the end of human beings. This system utilizes through the corruption vast human and material resources into the building of a tidily neat highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operation. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. We believe that democracy is transparency and control. We believe that the state needs of justice more than welfare. A state could exist without welfare, in bad condition, but not without law and justice. We and the victims of the 9th September are waiting justice and law in the respect of human rights and due process of law. We are for the respect of all the people and to reinforce the United Nations as an instrument of peace, fraternity, and justice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to follow up on the judge's presentation by bringing the discussion home somewhat for the benefit of this audience, both here and tuning in. Until the judge's works are translated into English, we're not going to benefit from his discoveries as we should, but there is a book that you may well not have heard of that came out last year to universal silence on the part of the media, called Operation Gladio by Paul Williams, okay? I hope that those claps are coming from people who have actually read the book, which is great to hear. Let me just tell you his story, because it will help make clear what we're really all up against. This is not just an Italian problem, although Operation Gladio has ravaged Italian democracy to a grotesque extent. Many people have died simply for trying to investigate that history. Paul Williams was a neoconservative who was a regular on Fox News and a consultant to the FBI on Islamic terrorism. That all changed after he did an expose of Islamburg, which is a training facility in upstate New York for radical converts to Islam who had made the conversion in our prisons. Okay? He discovered a federally supported training facility in upstate New York for these Islamic terrorists and wrote a piece about it. The scales fell from his eyes, okay? And also, he fell from the pedestal he'd been on. He was no longer invited to come on Fox and talk about stuff like this. He went on to write a fabulous book about the history of Operation Gladio, and it's from Prometheus Press. It's one of these books, that makes you feel like your head's going to explode. It's very, very thoroughly and carefully documented, and it tells the story of Operation Gladio, which began, was an idea actually by the Nazis at the end of World War II. It began as a program to support stay-behind armies in Europe who would rise up in the event of a Soviet invasion. There were weapons and bombs and all sorts of material stockpiled secretly all over Europe for the use of these elements to rise up. These elements were mostly former fascists and Nazis. This gradually mutated into a means whereby the deep state, as the judge has told us, a means of preventing the success of progressive democratic governments by basically arranging terrorist incidents that would then be blamed on the left. And that's what happened in Italy. That's what happened with the assassination of Aldo Moro. I remember as a young assistant professor hearing the news of his death, and everybody assumed, because everybody had been told, it was the work of the Red Brigades. Okay, that's just one of many crimes committed in Italy that was actually the work of these criminal elements in league with the P2 Masonic Lodge, which was very close to the Vatican. It's a little strange because Freemasons and the Vatican wouldn't seem to have a lot in common, but the fact is that they did. It was heavily connected, tightly connected to the Vatican's money laundering efforts, turning the dollars raised from drug sales around the world into money that could be spent on exercises like this. And behind it all is the CIA. Okay? This is kind of important information, and you're not going to find it in the New York Times. They're not going to talk about it on CNN. But it does, this is important, it does help us understand 9/11 a little bit better. I think the primary impediment to mass understanding of how and why that could happen is the bedrock assumption that we could never do anything like that. That couldn't happen here. We don't do that. We don't kill our own people. We don't do that. That's what the Nazis did. They burned down the Reichstag as a to enable them to go about their business. We don't do that. They do that to us. We don't do that to ourselves. Now, anyone who's studied the history of the Kennedy administration and that assassination and so on is sort of Operation Northwoods, which was a plan proposed in all seriousness by the Joint Chiefs to JFK to arrange terrorist incidents on American soil, resulting in the death of American citizens, which could then be pinned on Cuba, Castro's Cuba, which then would be sufficient grounds for invading that nation. Kennedy didn't like that idea, one of many reasons why he got popped, okay? This offended him deeply. But I mention it because it simply makes clear that this kind of scenario is not alien to us. It is part of our history. And in Italy, as the judge has told us, and as Paul Williams demonstrates, and there are other books on Operation Gladio, in Italy this was standard operating procedure. It also happened in Algeria, as the judge has told us, and Fethullah Gulen, you know, the reclusive, elderly, Turkish, Muslim cleric, preacher, and charter school network owner who was blamed by the president of Turkey for being behind the coup over there, the attempted coup. There's a whole chapter on Gulen in Paul Williams' book. He, too, is connected to Operation Gladio. So we're really very fortunate to have the judge with us today, and we have a few questions. How should we do this?
Okay. In this part, we have the help of an Italian translator, Margaret Matz, who's been so kind to help facilitate. And by the way, everybody should know that everything is archived today, which you will be able to access and hear over and over again on the internet and tell everybody in the universe to come visit. What has happened here this weekend? Bye.
Okay.
My first question, or the audience's first question: how did the Italian people react to your investigation of the killing of Aldo Moro and of Operation Gladio?
Come ha reagito il pubblico italiano alla vostra investigazione e l'uccisione di Aldo Moro? The judge would like to know when, now or at the time of the murder? Whoever asked the question.
Well, the question is, how did they react to his investigation?
Yes, I said that. He'd like to know the time frame.
At the time,
yeah.
At the time, the Italian people and I believe that Red Brigade were the only responsible of the kidnapping and of murder. And I discovered that there were some secret service involved in the connection with the Red Brigade, as Mossad, KGB, and the Islamic Secret Service. But I did not suppose that there was a complot of political nature. I discovered this fact after the after I wrote I possibility that had the possibility to know the document by Steve Pitsenik. This document have been hidden from the judges, and only many years after, I had the possibility to read this document. Is very important, because in this document he wrote during the kidnapping that the Italian minister was the responsible of the killing of a preparing of a kidnapping of Moro Chiesa. I did not imagine that there was a political complot plan. Only 30 years ago, when I wrote this book, I discovered this, because two important repented of Gladio, they spoke with me and told me sconvolgente, cosa dice così? Sconvolgente, cosa dice?
Overwhelming. Overwhelming.
Overwhelming news. And so I wrote the book, this book, but there is another one after 1 year, and I wrote all what I discovered, because it is better to write. So if I died, I leave my testimony. And so I think that this is a terrible truth. These people, this Pitsenik, I know that he made an important declaration. I did not suppose, he told, that the United States was a terrorist state. I have read. He is probably in New York. Should be interesting to speak another way, yeah, with him. And because I have not spoke with him, because he was an hidden, and he came back to United States during the kidnapping, at the end of the kidnapping. And now there is a trial, but I think that it will be finished without indictment of this. In any case, I believe in what I wrote in this.
Oh, yes.
Nobody has denied the truth that I affirmed in this book.
Yes, yes. I
want to give to Union University this book with my dedication to the student of university, in order they can know also the history of Italy, but other countries.
That's great. Thank you. I think the major part of the question is, how well do the Italian people know the results of his work, and what is their, how have they responded to his revelations?
Purtroppo, diciamo che i giornali non hanno accettato, the newspapers had not accepted my information. And so I wrote the book that had a big success. It was in first place in the classific of the book. He wins also the, but it's not this, the, another one after that. The 55 days that changed the history of Italy, issue 55. Now I think that the people start to understand that there it was a problem. Also because in Via Fani, where it was an attack against Moro, there were also some mafios of Reggio Calabria, and they was inserted in the Red Brigade by a Massone, and they participated to attack to the Moro bodyguard. Mm-hmm. It is unbelievable story. It is unbelievable. It is impossible to believe in this. I did not believe in this possibility for 30 years after I recognized to have made a mistake.
Yes.
Because there is a terrible truth that we must accept, because this is true, that regards our present and our future.
Yes, indeed. From his lips to God's ear, right? Isn't that true? So it sounds like it's the same story we have here, that the press will not review or mention these important books, which then gradually find a larger audience, so that there's a kind of generally unacknowledged awareness spreading through the population at large. It's the same in Italy as here, clearly. One other quick question. Do you agree with the analysis in Sanguinetti's book that the Red Brigades were actually controlled by the Italian Secret Service?
What's the name of the author?
Sanguinetti.
Sanguinetti. Sei d'accordo con l'analisi di Sanguinetti che le Brigate Rosse erano in coordinazione con il servizio segreto?
It is true, because the Red Brigade has been infiltrated by at least two Secret Service agents were connection between Red Brigade and the Secret Service. At least two people.
Okay.
But I prefer don't tell the name of this, because there are investigations against them. Now.
Okay, you don't have to.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, there's a slide that we would like the judge to talk about.
He shared this with me yesterday, coming from the airport. It's amazing. Please listen.
In 2012, reading the documents, the sentences, reading the sentences of my colleagues, reading the document of Moro Commission, reading documents of prosecutors, I found it many times Gladio and Gladio and the Secret Service in the same Via Sicilia, close to U.S. Embassy. But I made a list of this subject as a terrorist new order, as a Gladio stay behind, as a Secret Service or Office for Secret Service, CIA, Italian SID, Servizio Informazione Difesa, Italian CIFAR, Servizio Informazione Forze Armate, and also the P2 of Licio Gelli was in the same. There are also other connections with the Red Brigade and with the Agent Secret of Gheddafi. So in the same, I put this one, and I wrote a memorandum of the. Nobody denied that it is difficult to explain, but they were there.
And to be clear, is this Rome? Is this Rome?
It is Rome, Rome. Yes. Via Sicilia. It's una traversa di Via Veneto. It's a street che taglia Via Veneto. Quindi, the mythic Via Veneto di Federico Fellini, who is my friend, and he helped me in the search.
He made a list of all the organizations that are related to Gladio, and Judge Imposimato made a list of all the organizations that over the years he noticed were in the documentation of the investigation he was conducting, and of all the different organizations that were related to Gladio, and he prepared a visual of them. This is a map of a street in Rome called Via Sicilia, and the little markers represent the different addresses of the different organizations that were connected with Gladio.
I am ensuring that the number of the street where there is the different subject, and there are my wonder, meraviglia. I was surprised because in the same way there are subjects that should be antagonizing the order new terrorists and Secret Service, but this is the evidence that there were a lie. And a general, very true, after reading this, Imposimato has discovered that after 30 years. And his name is easy. General Inzerilli, he was interviewed by the journalist, and who wrote another book, and confirmed that this was the truth.
So he said that, you know, he wanted to stress a couple of points, and one point is that a general, over the 30 years, no one has really questioned this information over a period of 30 years, and that a general, General Inzerilli wrote a book and didn't question this information.
Also because I told that the decision to make attacks was not of Secret Service of Gladio, but by politicians. The politician is a level that decided what they had to do. And he was agreed, yes, because we have to understand that Secret Service were under control of the politician here and in Italy. I wrote this. Nobody has
denied. No one has disputed the information he's written.
Yeah, he came all the way from Italy to be with us, so please express
thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
There are heroes among us. I want to mention, too, in my professorial capacity, I mentioned more things to watch and read. There is a great BBC documentary on Operation Gladio that you can find on YouTube. I recommend that. And also, there's a brand new book called Revolution's End by Brad Schreiber from Skyhorse Publishing, which is about Patty Hearst and the SLA, Donald DeFries. It demonstrates very clearly that the SLA was created by the California prison system, Governor Reagan, and the CIA
as a way to infiltrate and discredit authentic leftist movements in California. And then it spun out of their control. Fascinating story that you're not going to find in Jeffrey Toobin's new book about Patty Hearst's kidnapping, which is, you know, a story that's easier to take. Okay. And so it goes. So you have to wait every year, you know, for an event like this to hear about some of these books. Too bad. We can't start listing books. There are so many great ones, but yes, David Talbot's The Devil's Chessboard, which is not about the SLA, but it's about an even worse criminal organization run by Alan Dulles. Okay, moving right along. We're now very lucky to be joined as a special guest speaker by Lionel. You may well know him and his work as a trial lawyer, an Emmy Award winning, nationally syndicated American radio and TV personality, a legal analyst, essayist, lecturer, actor, author, etc. He's publicly posed very tough questions about the 9/11 attacks, which is unusual for a public figure in the media. So please join me in welcoming Lionel.
Thank you. So did you tell your friends where you were going today? Did you tell them? They say, oh, there's that Larry. He's going to that 9/11 thing. You know how Larry is, tinfoil hat guy. By the way, we haven't worn tin in years. It's aluminum foil. Just want to clarify that for you. Let me tell you what happened to me, and we all have a story, what it was that got your attention. In my lifetime, in my generation, I went through, either as a child or old enough to understand, from the Vietnam War to a five-year period of assassinations from JFK to RFK to Martin Luther King to Malcolm X to Medgar Evers, then there's Watergate, then there's Vietnam. So I have believed absolutely nothing that was ever provided to me as remotely representing the facts by the government or the mainstream sheeple, the bumper sticker, echo chamber, cookie cutter, corporate bought and sold media, sock puppet. I don't believe anything. Nothing. Let me repeat this. Nothing. And I'm in the media. So I really am an expert witness. Let me tell you what happened to me. This was my epiphany. I speak for myself. I don't represent any group. I'm not a truther, a falser, a vaxxer, a birther, a deather, none of that. I'm me. That's it. Let me tell you my epiphany moment. Sadly, I was here that day, that beautiful Tuesday. It was gorgeous. A sky so blue, pre-geoengineering and nanoparticulates in the air. Don't get me started on that, too. That's another one. The only thing you can point to with somebody next to you and say, what's that? Oh, there you go again with the conspiracy theories. No, what is that? There you go. Amazing. So I was there and went through the horror, the surreal horror that everybody did. I was bombarded by information, bombarded by you name it. I couldn't keep track of what was being said, what was being hit, who was saying what. I didn't think cover-up, conspiracy, nothing. Who could? Who in this maelstrom, this horror, this symphony of death, and the smell, it reminded you every day, that smell. It was like when an engine burns out in an old vacuum cleaner or something. It hung everywhere. It was horrible. I thought nothing. I thought, this is the way it was. I wasn't even questioning anything. And then one day I was on the radio, and somebody mentioned to me this thing called Shanksville. Flight 93. Yeah. I knew. I thought I did. I don't know. I'm still shocked. I'm not a conspiracist or any of that stuff. I'm a lawyer. I'm a trial lawyer. I was a prosecutor. I like this thing called evidence. Call me wacky. So I looked one day as somebody was calling in about Flight 93. Let's roll. Beamer, the whole bit. I can recite the story like everybody else could. I didn't doubt it. I was still trying to sift through so many stories. North Tower, South Tower, Building 7, which I didn't even know about then. The greatest mystery of them all, Flight 93 Shanksville and the Pentagon. That was that. Then there were the issues involving health and first responders and the government and drills. And I mean, who could sift through this? So there I was. I looked at my Google images, and I'm looking for this plane crash. Stupid me. They said Flight 93, Shanksville, a plane crash. And I'm looking at Google images because sometimes I will kind of cut it. Do you ever try to find somebody's face? Like, what was that guy's name? Images. Oh, yeah, him. And then you go to the web. Oh, it was Larry. So I'm looking for this thing. And I'm looking. And on the air, I said, you ready for this? Brilliant. You know what I asked? Where's the plane? Thinking nothing. Stupid me. Where's the plane? Please, no Hervé Villechaize jokes, but you know, the plane, right? So I'm no expert in aeronautical crashes. I'm not a forensic pathologist. I can tell when people are dead. I'm not an OBGYN. I can tell when people are pregnant. And I can tell a plane crash. Again, call me wacky. I'm a savant. I'm gifted. You know, wheels, wings, stabilizers, people, luggage, glass, wire, smoke, gas, fill in the blank. And I asked the question, where's the plane? Phone call. Line one, what are you getting at? What am I getting at? Oh, I don't know. I'm getting at, where's the plane? Are you a conspiracy theorist? I said, I've got a question for you. What the hell are you talking about? Am I looking in the right place? That's all I want to know. Then I'm reading. Stupid me. And I'm reading in, you know, not you know, Skippy's blog, some kid in his parents' basement, you know, with Cheeto dust and I'm reading, you know. And they bring up New Baltimore and Indian Lake, and 8 miles away, there's a debris field. I said, hey, there's a debris field 8 miles from there. Do you know what somebody said? Google this. Well, it was windy that day. 6-ton titanium engines. That's when I realized, oh my God. It wasn't, oh my God, that the horror. But I understood that I am an alien. And I live in this parallel universe that requires proof. And then a friend of mine called up and he said, you know, you might want to look here, 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 and here, and here. And it started. And then I'm in this. I'm thinking, what's going on here? Now, let me just cut to the chase here because I don't want to, please. Somebody give me a time cue. Les, I'm an old stand-up comic. Give me a flashlight or something. I don't want to go over. All right. But when you're a prosecutor and you walk in, there's a homicide. There's four kinds of death. think of this acronym, NASH. Natural, accidental, suicide, homicide. That's it. So if we walk in, hypothetically, and there's an old lady, bless her heart, handcuffed behind her back with 12 shots in the head, and somebody asks you, is that natural, accidental, suicide, or homicide? You could say, well, I don't think that's natural. I don't think that's accidental. Suicide, Houdini, maybe a contortionist, perhaps, but no. No, I'm going to put my money on homicide. That's over here. There's something wrong here. Question then comes to, who did it? I don't know who did it. Why would they want to kill this woman? She was a beautiful person, a grandmother. I don't know why. So that's what I want the world to know. Please separate the incredible evidence that Richard Gage has done. And by the way, when C-SPAN finally just grew a pair and had to put you on, I thought maybe there is a God. And maybe she's fair. I don't know. But don't confuse something that indicates that the official story is wrong with who is involved in it. Because we don't know. We don't know these things. You can't tell. Now, I know people who have never in their lives ever been involved in anything involving critical thinking. This is their first rodeo. And you hear this all the time. Is this cognitive dissonance? Is this a smoking gun? Is this an inside job? Hey, Sparky, take it easy. You're reading the bumper stickers too much. If I hear cognitive dissonance one more time, I'm going to take a life. I'm going to stab somebody in the heart with a pencil. Stop the cognitive dissonance. That's like people say, it's harp. Stop with the harp. What do you read this stuff from? It's an inside job. It's either the Mossad, it's Cheney with the plunger. We don't know this. If somebody can tell me where to go for that, you let me go, because I've been looking for this, but that's not what this is about. Here's the thing. Gore Vidal said three things about conspiracy theories, which I'll never forget. Number one, he said, one day it will be an article of faith that you do not believe in conspiracy theories. Number one. Number two, conspiracy theories are code word for the unspeakable truth. And finally, my favorite. He said, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm a conspiracy analyst. Now, by definition, the official story is that a number of people, 1920 hijackers, conspired, confederated, joined together to pull this off. That's a conspiracy. So yes, this is the conspiracy theory by their very words. I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in simply this. This is, I believe, a great, great country, capable of being even greater. And John Pilger said, and others, don't believe anything until it's officially denied. And you have the right, the absolute right, to ask anything you want, any time you want, for as long as you want, until you're satisfied. And it is absolutely, fundamentally, not only your right, but your duty. And you're going to meet people, and I've met people before, who are the anti-conspiracy theorists. They get jollies out of mocking, destroying anything that anybody suggests might be an alternative version to reality, as expressed by the bought and sold sock puppet Ted Baxter mainstream media. They take relish in fighting you because they don't like you. And the main reason they don't like you is they don't know anything about what you're talking about. And this would involve them reading. So what I'm saying to you today, why I am all here to celebrate this, to encourage this, I wish this place were packed. I wish students and young people will be pulled in here to say, this is what happens. We need our own Russell Commission, our own permanent committee to just ask questions. We're still trying to figure out the Civil War. I'm listening to lectures by the greatest historians now trying to decipher the Civil War. We don't even understand Vietnam. And I'm supposed to give you an answer as to everything that happened on 9/11? Not yet. Thank you for allowing me the chance to be here. Congratulations to you. Congratulations to you and all the independent scholars, independent historians, citizen journalists, and those people with an open mind and an open heart. Because this isn't their story or their history, it's our history and our story. And we can ask it for as long as we want or as much as we want. Thank you.
That was really great. Yeah, conspiracy theory is something that, if true, you couldn't handle it, right? Isn't that what a conspiracy theory is? I have to tell a really quick story. I wrote a book about the theft of the 2004 election. It's called Fooled Again. It came out in 2005 and got reviewed nowhere and so on. It's attacked by the left, interestingly enough, and ignored by the mainstream press. So I went all over the country, appearing on radio shows and so on, doing my best to spread the word about it, and I was somewhere talking about it, coming up with the evidence that the election had been stolen, because it's copious. And caller number one, extremely angry, extremely aggressive, and his response to what I'd said was, Mark Crispin Miller is the author of a book claiming that 9/11 was an inside job. Okay, I had never written such a book, you know. I hadn't even thought about 9/11 yet, because I was my brain pan was filled with the election theft, so I couldn't really fit all that other stuff in yet. But that shows you that there is a script that is used by people who I think are hired, that are on the payroll, to discredit anyone who raises those forbidden questions, and that's what we're up against. Now, for a change of pace and an important one, the motive force behind much of the truth that we know about 9/11 has been the survivors of 9/11 and their families. These are the people who have very bravely come forward, not in all that many cases, and for understandable reasons, because of the trauma that they've suffered. These are the people who have come forward and pressed and demanded that the government do something to arrive at the truth about that day. The 9/11 Commission wouldn't have happened, wouldn't have been formed, if it weren't for the New Jersey moms and others who insisted that there be a proper commission. The commission that they formed wasn't a proper commission, as it turned out, and the government did everything it could to block it and stonewall it and so on. Nevertheless, the fact that there even was one was the result of this kind of heroic effort, and Congress's passage of JASTA yesterday, allowing American citizens to sue Saudi Arabia for sponsoring terrorist attacks on American soil, that too was the result of these heroic efforts by the families. But we're joined today by Bob McIlvaine. He's a retired school teacher from the Philadelphia area, whose son, Robert Jr., worked for Merrill Lynch as an assistant vice president of media relations. And on that morning, he was at a banking conference on the 106th floor of the North Tower. He's one of the, Bob Sr. is one of the few family members to openly challenge the official narrative. He's traveled the country and the world as a featured guest at peace conferences and 9/11 events. He appears in the film Zero, an investigation into 9/11. He's dedicated his life to discovering the truth and seeking justice for his son and all the rest who perished on that day. So please join me in welcoming Bob McIlvaine. Thank you.
I have something here. I've never done this before when I speak, but I'm going to read this in a couple minutes. But I, Mark said it, Bobby did not die on the 106th floor. And I'm getting emotional already. I do this every year. And Lionel, that's a tough act to follow. I just don't have no jokes. Not that he's joking, but I mean, he was great. Everyone's been great. But I just wanted to say that Bobby worked at Merrill Lynch. He'd only been there like 3 weeks. He was assistant vice president. They hired him because he was just such a phenomenal writer. He wanted to be a novelist. They made a deal with him that they would send him to graduate school at either Harvard or Penn if he worked 2 years for him. And after 2 years, he could make that decision whether or not to leave. Well, they did have a conference on the 106th floor, but, and again, I don't want to go in detail. Oftentimes, I do talk about Bobby because I know what happened to Bobby, and I hate to get in conflict with other family members around the United States, you know, talking about what I think of the grand scheme of 9/11. But Bobby got out. He lived in 96 between first and second, or yeah, 66 between first and second, and every day would go to the John Jay College right there. I think there was an entrance to the subway. I think go down the Fulton Street. And I've spent a lot of time trying to figure this out. I mean, I just didn't, you know, we came up immediately. Well, anyway, he got off at Fulton Street, walked down to the towers, and I don't know if he was cutting through the tower or walking up to the 106th floor, but I can prove beyond a reasonable doubt that he died instantly from an explosion, and I really do believe it was before the towers were hit by a plane. And again, I'm not going to go into the gruesome details, but we found him on Thursday and took him home. Excuse me. Took him home Friday and buried him the following Tuesday. So we were one of the lucky few that actually had a body to take home with us. And that's something special. My wife, Helen, is here now. We spent a good hour at the grave last night, or yesterday afternoon, just to, I go there every week. And not many non-elected family members have that. So that's something special. So again, I didn't come here to talk about Bobby. I could go on for hours about Bobby. He was a Princeton grad, great writer, so forth. Really, he knew where he was going in life. And he's a very progressive person, especially coming out of Princeton, in a very conservative college or university. And he was a tremendous writer. All right, so let me just go on from that. My wife, she is here, and I want to thank Richard Gage for last year. My wife, first time she's come to an event that I came to. She's always supported me about 9/11, but just wanted to stay away from it. You know, she wouldn't criticize me, she wouldn't say anything, but I did my own thing. Well, she listened to Richard last year, and she just loved the science, not loved it, but the science of what happened to those buildings. Because Bobby died at the North Tower, he didn't die from the collapse, she knew that. But the science just, you know, it just opened up her eyes. So she's been a big part in the last year, and in this speech that I have right here. And it's called Connecting the Dots. And then I've always said, and I firmly believe this, and I tell people this, but I was a history teacher, but that's about as far as it goes. I was a bar owner also. So, you know, I'm not, you know, a legal expert or anything of that sort, but I love reading history. I read more history than I do read stuff about 9/11. It's understanding the nature of man. How can men do things like this? As Lionel was saying, or Mark was saying, he said that someone said that people just can't believe that the United States would do something like this. Just can't wrap their minds around it. I don't talk about 9/11. My wife doesn't want to take me to parties because she's so afraid that I'm going to talk about it. And I said, I would never bring it up. But if someone would ask me a question, I'll talk about it. Well, even that, she gets upset because people just get so glassy-eyed. And it's just like, you know, it's like the father image. How can your father be that evil to do something like that? So that's why people can't wrap themselves around it. So the history part of it is so important to me. But for me to come up here, again, I'm not an authority on history. People want to hear my story, what happened on 9/11. Well, two people that are here this weekend, William Pepper, of course, I read his books, and his book that's out now, Who Killed Martin Luther King, and his other books, and I know William from other events that we've had, and Danny Sheehan. I saw his four-part, or listened to his four-part show on the Gary Null Show. Well, that should be heard by everyone in the United States and throughout the world. It's so I changed my mind what I was going to do today, and I hope I still have time. I hope I don't get cut off here. But it just changed my mind. Let's just talk about, you know, I'm not going to talk about history, but I'm going to talk about my journey and how people should look, you know, do their research. And hearing the judge talk about Operation Gladio, which I just mentioned in here, this is the most important thing. Everyone has to understand how the politics of the world works, how money works. It's the power. It's the extreme power. And I think if you really spend that time looking at history, then you can understand 9/11 can happen. You know, 3,000 people died. You know, again, as I mentioned here, and I'll, you know, I'm sorry, I'll get to it real fast, but, you know, I've been to Colombia, I've been to Japan, I walked with the Bakasha, and the horror around the world forever. And who benefits from this? You know, Smedley Butler's book, War is a Racket. And that's, so the essence, that's what, that's the way I feel, and I feel good about that, because I don't have to worry about, let's just talk, you know, we talk about, you know, Shanksville, let's talk about the buildings coming down, let's talk about NORADs, and it just goes on and on and on. And of course, if I'm sitting with someone, that just goes above their head. So anyway, my wife and I and my son actually helped in this also. We put this together. It's called Connecting the Dots. I got to take my glasses off. Connecting the Dots of 9/11 by Robert Helen and Jeffrey. How I Learned That Peace May Never Be Achieved. Let me get myself in order here. Since Bobby's death on 9/11, I have been on a journey to find the truth of how and why he died, and who really killed him. I was not satisfied from the beginning with the official story of his death. I also feared that violence around the world would escalate as a result of this horrendous act. In 2002, I joined September 11th Family for Peaceful Tomorrows, a group of activists whose name was inspired by a Martin Luther King statement, "Wars are poor chisels for carving out peaceful tomorrows." In the early part of the new decade, we marched hand in hand for peace in Washington and New York, hoping that 9/11 would not be justification for increased war efforts. I'll never forget the moment when I was arrested on the Capitol lawn, proudly carrying a banner stating, "Not my son's name," with a picture of his, picture of Bobby right here, which referred to the use of 9/11 by Bush to further any war efforts. Later that year, at the World Conference of Victims on Victims of Violence in Bogota, Colombia, I told Bobby's story to a packed audience of survivors of various atrocities. I was honored to have the opportunity to share my pain and grief with those who truly understand the price of violence. Back in the United States, I regularly attended the 9/11 Commission hearings, patiently listening to testimony while hoping to find answers to an official story that contained or continued to make little sense. Instead, I felt frustrated with the inability of the Commission to discover anything new or enlightening. Witnesses, including Condoleezza Rice, were not accountable to the commission or the American people. Ms. Rice, to my dismay, filibustered her way through each of the questions posed by the commissioners. I returned home very, very discouraged. In 2005, on the 60th anniversary of the atomic bombing, I was asked to join Peaceful Tomorrows on a march from Nagasaki to Hiroshima. And in that march, we pushed or pulled a 2,000-pound tombstone. And honoring those who died in war. I walked beside the Hibakusha, survivors of the attack. They showed amazing pride, never taking on the role of a victim, though many were treated as outcasts by their own people. The Hibakusha's courage impressed in me the need to continue my quest for peace and truth. I returned home, deciding that the United States, if the United States government was not going to give me the answers to 9/11, then I'd find them myself. Why, I wonder, was it so hard to go against the government's version of a story that did not make sense? I wanted to know why the media always seemed as far from a free press as one could imagine, often ignoring obvious breakthroughs in information. Why also did peace seem even further away than before 9/11? Frustrating, of course, myself and the peace community. Our children died that horrible day, and it was now being used as fodder for more escalation, more deaths. My quest for truth took me to both the traditional history sources as well as books written by outstanding authors who questioned the company line and sought deeper answers than what was offered by the news or the press conferences. As I searched, I recalled quotes from Eisenhower, Kennedy, Franklin Roosevelt, Martin Luther King, initially read years ago by me, when their dire warnings meant little to a young college student, studying history, by the way. Eisenhower, in a famous speech in 1961, warned of the dangers of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. Kennedy, later that year, warned of a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. Fascinated by these predictions of such stellar leaders, I began to probe further, seeing patterns, taking a harder look at the circumstances leading to the invasions of Iraq and Afghanistan. I looked further back, farther back in history, reading about Operation Gladio in the Gulf of Tonkin in a different, more knowledgeable light. Was 9/11 another false flag? I was beginning to see the truth. I wondered if presidents truly had any power to wage peace, where special interest groups with unimaginable wealth and power, who are often referred to as the shadow government, shadow masters, deep state, controlling the decisions of war. After more continued research, I learned that these clandestine operations would never allow control of the government to the people. They would instead rely on disinformation. Weapons of mass destruction in Iraq is obviously a perfect example. Fabrication of injustices and the spreading of propaganda to justify their aggressive acts. Could these elite few be responsible for the upheavals in so many countries, when it appeared to the general public that they were in these countries to spread or promote democracy? As I continue my reading, I recalled a quote from Joseph Goebbels, Hitler's propaganda minister. You tell a big lie enough and keep repeating it, people eventually come to believe it. He went on to say that the truth is the mortal enemy of the lie, and thus by extension, the truth is the greatest enemy of the state. Sadly, I came to the conclusion, best said by Woodrow Wilson, and fortunately true today, we have come to one of the worst ruled, one of the most completely controlled and dominated governments in the civilized world. No longer governed by opinion, no longer governed by conviction and the vote of the majority, but a government by the opinion and the duress of small groups of dominant men. from hours and hours of research, I have learned that the 9/11, the truth of 9/11 and the truth regarding who really holds the power in this country and throughout the world are not in our best interest to know, according to those elite few who choose to control our destiny. Unfortunately, peace and the truth are not part of that destiny. Thank you.
To introduce our third and final guest speaker before lunch, Dylan Avery, Les Jamieson.
Thank you. After our next speaker, I'll return for a few seconds just to give some details on lunch, okay? And it's been a pretty powerful morning, would you say? An incredible way to start off a weekend, which I think is encapsulated by a quote that Bob McIlvaine just read, is truth is the enemy of the deep state power faction. And we are here to make sure that that our ability to learn the truth, spread the truth, convey the truth, and act on it, which you'll hear much more about throughout this next section this afternoon, our ability to act on the truth will make the difference to dissipate and literally make the lie and the myth of 9/11 and all the other deep state crimes exactly what they are. It's fabrications and falsehoods which were created to control and to carry out the interest of a powerful few, but it's not their world, it's our world. So, now, as part of the incredible raising of consciousness to the point that there is a widespread awareness of the deceptions of 9/11, of the major glaring discrepancies and questions. This has come about through the hard work of activists, of creative people, making film, books, documentaries, and there's one in particular that really stands out because there's a film, by the way, that has a funny name that we, you know, were mystified by for many years, Loose Change. And it was seen, yes. And this next speaker and his partners are very clever. And the way this came about is phenomenal. I know Dylan will speak about it, but it's very important to know that this film was seen by tens of millions of people. It was basically, I would say, realized by media professionals to be the, quote, the first internet blockbuster. And along with C-SPAN documentaries seen by tens of millions of people, the world has become aware of the fact that there are millions of people who say no to the lie. And so we're very honored to have Dylan Avery with us because he, I think, is a towering figure still in this culture-changing event and in this culture-changing movement to stand for truth. Please welcome Dylan Avery.
Oh, no, we're starting with that.
I haven't done anything like this in about 10 years, and the last time I did something like this, I was standing, I believe, in this exact spot here at Cooper Union in 2006. It's crazy to be back here. With that being said, I was going to write up a bunch of remarks, but usually when I write something and read it, it just doesn't come out the right way. So I'm going to start by saying it's great to see everybody here. It's great to be back. It's great to see an Investigate 9/11 shirt, so bravo, sir, for wearing that. It's been 15 years. Like, it's been 15 years. And just to put that into context, I don't know if any of you in the audience have kids that are entering into freshman year of high school. Bless you. But this will be the first year where high school students will be learning about 9/11 as an event that happened before they were born. Whereas for me, 9/11 was basically my introduction to the real world, as it could be called, because I was in the process of graduating high school. I was actually already supposed to be out, if anyone in the audience knows this story, sorry, but basically I was already supposed to be graduated, but I had to retake one class for a semester, so I spent most of 9/11 watching it on TV, like everybody else. I just did it in the media room of our high school. So it's weird to think that for me it was like this life-changing event that I feel we're all still dealing with the repercussions of, and yet you'll have some people that tell you when you bring up 9/11 to get over it or forget about it or it's been 15 years, but then you turn on the TV and someone's using it as justification for whatever. So it's kind of weird, you know, people tell you to get over it, but then they use it against you as ammunition. And one thing I did want to say, because I was hoping to get here a little early, I took the bus here over from Jersey, and as I'm walking out of the Port Authority, I look up to my right, and what do I see? A giant banner advertising Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. Yeah. I had to... Yes. I take off my glasses, rub my eyes, like, yeah, wow. So that's... We've come a long way since 9/11 because we see things like that where we definitely wouldn't have seen it in 2002, 3, 4, 5, I don't think even 6. So we have come a long way because it's a lot easier to have discussions. And another one of the reasons I was late is because I was waiting for this box of DVDs to show up. I'm giving out these 5 and I'm bringing another box to give out tomorrow. I was sitting around waiting for this delivery that Corey overnighted from Redondo Beach that ran late, of course, but it showed up right as I was waiting to leave for my bus. So I got 5 to hand out today and another box to just give out tomorrow. If any of you can make copies and distribute it the way we did about 10 years ago, that would be amazing. Speaking of 10 years ago, it's just crazy to think that, you know, the next day, 10 years ago, we had thousands of people at Liberty Park, right across the street from Ground Zero. Was anyone there? We got, of course you were there. I got this guy. Anyone else? I took my glasses off. We got a couple. Fantastic. Awesome. That was crazy. We had thousands of, for those of you in the audience that were not there, we had thousands of people in black shirts that said, Investigate 9/11. We gave out, I believe, 600 shirts and 10,000 DVDs, and it was just, we took over Lower Manhattan. There was no avoiding us. It's still crazy to think that we got away with that. We had uniformed police officers marching with us, for what it's worth, and we actually, there's footage of FDNY firefighters stopping us on the street and asking us for shirts, and we're like, so what's up, you know, loose change, huh? What do you think? And they're like, well, you know, I have two cameras like right in their faces, you know, and they're like, well, you know, I'm not at liberty to say, we're aware of the whole situation. So what does that mean? Have you seen it? Are you guys, we're aware of the whole situation. And that's all we got out of them. But, it, you know, this was good enough for us, you know, and it was nice little ammunition to kind of walk down to Ground Zero. And that actually, I wasn't there for that because I was too busy on Democracy Now! With Jason Burmes debating popular mechanics. That was fun. That was fun. Yeah. Man. You know, do I have a couple more minutes? Yeah, just go? Okay, cool. Perfect. I mean, I was working at Red Lobster when the original Loose Change came out, and one of the first things I did, and actually it's kind of funny, I was sitting around waiting for the shipment to show up so I could grab a DVD and run to work with it, Because I'd been annoying slash pestering my coworkers for the last like couple weeks. I got this film, and it's about 9/11, and I don't, what's it about? I'll give you a copy. It's just easier if I give you a copy, you watch it, and you get back to me. So I was so excited. I sit around this like giant freight truck shows up with like boxes full of DVD. I'm like 18, or no, I'm 20 years old at this point. I'd never really done anything like that. So I grabbed a DVD and I hopped and got the bus and I went down to Red Lobster, and that DVD I never saw again. Because I gave it to one coworker, and they were like, "Oh, you know, Renee wants to borrow. Can I give it to him when I'm done?" And then I'd go to Renee, and he's like, "Oh, no, I gave it to Maceo." And then Maceo gave it to my boss. So I didn't think I'd have a job after that. But then I was asked by KPFK to fly out to California, and we did a little screening tour in churches and occasionally a cinema, but usually like a church or an empty community hall. It was great. Not knocking at all. It was amazing. It was magical times. Just rented out a couple venues. Well, KPFK took care of all of it, and they flew Corey and I out and got to see California for the first time, got to be on a plane for the first time. So when I got back from that trip, I was supposed to still be on the schedule, so maybe this was my boss firing me, actually. But when I came back from California, I was no longer on the schedule, so I either had to beg and plead for my job back at Red Lobster or to just kind of take this loose change thing and run with it. So that's what I did, and that was the first edition. And then that November, right at the end of November, Cindy Sheehan came to upstate New York and spoke at SUCO, our local state college, and a reporter was there, and saw her. We literally just got him in the mail, our Investigate 9/11 shirts, and we were pumped up. We had two burned copies of the second edition that we had just finished up. We were going to give one to Cindy Sheehan and one to whoever else, and whoever else turned out to be Doug Kolk, a reporter at WICZ News out of Binghamton. At first he was like, "Oh, you know, I'm going to try and incorporate you guys into the Cindy Sheehan story. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do it." So then, as we're sitting there watching the Cindy Sheehan story, we don't see ourselves. You know, we weren't terribly shocked. I mean, we were still disappointed because the dude did say he was going to put us on TV. We were like, "Oh man, that sucks. So maybe next time." So as we're sitting there watching the Cindy Sheehan piece, I get a call on my cell phone, and it's Doug Kolk, and he's like, "Hey man, I'm sorry. I'm sure you guys just saw it. The only reason you weren't there tonight is because I want to give you guys your own piece." So then he proceeds to ask me what the best evidence would be to put in it. So I'm like, "All right, well, you got the collapse of Building 7 over here, and you've got the molten steel underneath the Twin Towers. That's a really good one." And he's like, I imagine him jotting down notes on the other end. And he's like, "Yeah, that's great. That's perfect. I'll go through the interviews, and I'll let you know if I have any more questions." And then a couple nights later, we were on Fox. It was crazy. We weren't only on Fox once. We were on Fox a second night, and then we were on Fox a third night to have a special about, because there was no YouTube, you know, there was barely Google Video. These platforms were just getting started, so it wasn't like it was on YouTube the next day. But someone we ripped it off TV and uploaded it to our website, and then someone in Germany posted it on a message board. And then before we knew it, Doug Kolk is calling me. He's like, "Yo, you guys just got our servers shut down." And at first we're like, "Oh my God, what do you mean shut down? Like, did someone show up? You know, and like, really, you know, you guys okay?" But it's just it got so much traffic, it crashed our servers. And, you know, so they're, you know, Fox is getting emails like, "You better put that story back up, we know you guys pulled it," you know, and just like, it was just funny. But it was just because the story was so damn popular. All right, 1 minute, perfect. It was nuts. It was just absolutely nuts. And so it's great to be back on a stage talking to you all. I got a film. I mean, it's tangentially related because we've seen the militarization of the police department in the wake of 9/11. Because I was talking to my girlfriend yesterday. It's like, you didn't really hear a lot of these officer-involved shootings. I mean, you did. You heard about them, Rodney King and things like that. But it seems like ever since the Bush administration and the influx of the militarization and the Department of Defense practically giving tanks to police departments, you've seen a lot more people get killed. So on that somewhat related note, in February 2014, I started making a film about police brutality because of the beating of Kelly Thomas out in L.A. It was really upsetting to me at the time. That was February 2014, so 7 months later, Ferguson happens. I'm 7 months into production of my film about the police, and that, and then Baltimore, and then everything else that happened. So I'm just in the final stages of wrapping that up. I've been taking a long time to work on it because I don't want there to be a black and blue second edition. I just want it to be done and out and to watch it and be happy with it. not that I wasn't happy with first loose change, but it was a little different when you had new information coming out every day. So I think that's about it for my time. I'm going to be hanging out here a little bit for today, and then tomorrow, like I said, I'm back with the case of DVDs. There's this author, George, that's flying in from Australia. I think he's going to have his book here with him. So I got 5 DVDs for anybody that wants to make copies or just anyone. This is a 52-minute cut. It's basically what's on digital networks now, and someone asked us for DVDs to hand out. So, okay, here you go. Thank you, everybody.
Also, big shout out to Dylan's partners, Corey Rowe and Jason Burmis. These kids are amazing. Okay. Guess what, folks? We're actually pretty close to being on time. And just relax for 1 minute. I just want to announce that for those who would like to eat lunch from the food vendor here, go out that door. And you'll see some tables with sandwiches and beverages. You could go outside to the park. There's a few parks around within a block. And enjoy yourselves. And the speakers come right through that door to the left. That's where we will be. And staff as well. And a lot more to come this afternoon, folks. So we will start back here 2:30, okay? Please be seated and ready to go. Thank you.